It on now, I reckon.
Shall I turn that light off again?
Yeah, you can do if you want.
How's that?
That's better. We are live, by the way.
That's right. So it looks like I've got a lamp on my head.
How you doing, Des?
I'm all right. Thank you very much, Joe. And I hope everybody else out there is all right. The weather's turning.
It's pretty crap today, isn't it?
Crap for the weekend again, isn't it? Typical English weather, really. But apart from that, yeah, I'm all right, mate. Good.
Been having a bit of a fishing, yeah?
Yeah, I've been out fishing a little bit. I'm obviously raring now. I've actually got me rigs. So some of my rigs that I've used, some of them there, look, I'm going to restart retying. So that tells you something.
Have you got a little cloth or a little tissue or something just to give the iPad camera a little rub? It's giving the juice.
Are you trying to say that my missus has got the iPad through?
I don't know. There's a few streaks kicking off.
Where is it? Where's the camera?
Be a little dot. There we go. Yeah, that's it. I think that's better. Right, that's a great image, isn't it? You clean.
Look at that.
Oh, look at that now. HD.
Let me do it again. That's not a very... No, that's like...
Yeah, that is thick and span now.
That is what we call pin sharp.
That is pin sharp. So you've been fishing?
I've been fishing. Not loads. Been out with Jake doing some new... We've got some new Sonya Bates... stuff coming. Obviously been out with you because we've got loads of new Preston stuff coming.
It's all good at the moment.
Yeah, it's all back to... Is that square, that thing?
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah, it's all getting back to square one. Match, I'm booked into Topper Manor Monday. Next Monday, obviously, for the first match. That's going to feel really weird.
Yeah.
And then Tuesday, I've got not one of my best things. I'm out with Richard Chapman, who does all in angling. Everybody, probably people that would know that. I'm actually filming a match live.
Yeah.
Which anybody who knows me,
I don't like them, do you?
I don't particularly like them, even though I know you guys. I know you guys love them, but they're not the best for me because I just don't like them. I just feel, I don't know, but that's me. Anyway, I'm doing that Tuesday, so yeah, it's all getting. Thank God we're back match fishing.
Yeah, there's loads of matches going on as well, isn't there? So it's going to be good. I'm really looking forward. Yeah. You know, I was like not really feeling it, and then I went pleasuring for a couple of hours last week. And I loved it. And that's it now. I'm making rigs all week.
I went down with Mark Bartlett at Acorn Fisheries, which is obviously just down the road from me. And I went down last Saturday. Oh, my God, we've got Elstones now. It's shocking, isn't it?
Shocking to
that. So I went out yesterday and done some hard pellet fishing. And it was bloody brilliant. I enjoyed it. I was only there for 3 hours. I probably caught like 80-odd pounds.
I seen you putting your fish back. I was like, bloody hell, Des.
Yeah, brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. We're only messing around. But the quality, it's just like the quality of the fish in that down there and the size, and you catch all sorts of
fish. We need to do something there, actually.
Yeah, it's bloody brilliant. Well, it's really, really enjoyable. And it was dead still. You know, it was pretty cold, though, as the sun sort of started going down. It went really cold.
There's something we've got to discuss before we go any further into fishing. A lot of people have seen your little video bezzing around on the bike.
Well, I will do a little bit. Let me just pick my iPad up and I'll show you. I'll show you what the situation is here at the minute, boys and girls. Obviously my garage is a fishing garage, if you like, mostly fishing garage. I've got a few bits and pieces in. I've actually got 3 motorbikes in here at the moment.
I've got three now.
I've had to take one out. I've had to take one out because I can't actually get in my garage. So the little bike that I bought, I've had a proper...
I didn't realise you had 3. I knew you had 2.
Oh, there's me Enduro, look, which anybody out there wants to have a buy that, that's a YZ450. I know it's a fishing thing, but if anybody's interested, message me, because it is a great little bike. I just want the same money as what I bought it for. Outside in the pouring rain is my new motocross bike, which I was out the other day messing about it, running it in. I had a real good price on that. It's not like a 2021. It's a 2018, but... Yeah, motocross, Meredith Motocross in Bristol. That'd be a real good deal. And I got my road bike, which is like a ghost. Well, there you go. That's the end of that. Let's get onto the serious side of this fishing time. But if anybody wants to buy my Enduro, message me because it is a real good bike. I'll sign whatever you want for it. I just want the same money that I bought for it. It's a road bike. It's brilliant condition. I've looked after it because I am OCD, as you know, with servicing and looking after stuff. So, and my poor old motocross is out in the pouring rain at the moment, just so I can speak to you guys.
So give you some room.
yeah, just to give me a bit of room to move about.
Brilliant, brilliant. But
anyway, apart from that, everything's pretty good. I've had my vaccine. I've had my vaccine, so that's good.
No after effects?
I had my vaccine last Saturday, and I felt a bit sick on Sunday morning.
Felt like he had a hangover.
Yeah, well, my missus was, she had theirs Friday, and then Saturday she felt like a bit groggy.
Yeah, that's what Dad said he felt.
But to be honest,
good, isn't it?
I had nothing really. Yeah, it is good.
You can see it on the figures, can't you? You know, it's plummeting down now, and it's obviously working. So
just, we get a bit of sun now, and then it'll, I'm sure it'll be unky-dory.
Let's get life back to normal.
Yeah.
Should we crack on?
I reckon we crack on. Shall I start this off?
Yes, please do. Yeah, this is a good one.
There's a couple, because I obviously went fishing yesterday, and people say, Des, why have you hooked a band and not a hair rig? Now, I've spoken about this on Facebook in that quite a few times, and I, over the last, because this is what I used to do years ago before hair rigging pellets were about, and obviously I am a big fan of hair rigging, but I do like just hooking the band.
Doesn't it?
For carp, especially, I think it's bloody brilliant.
Especially on the bottom.
Yeah, on the bottom, definitely. And all I've been using, I'll tell you, I've got 16 GPM on, which is just pre-tied. And yesterday I used, obviously, it depends on what size pellets you're using. But there are little medium bands. I'm not just saying it because they are Preston. There's something about them. They are just a perfect size. So that's what I used yesterday on a 6mm. And obviously use the small ones if I'm using like a 4mm or a 6mm. But just to clarify everything, I just get them out of the packets. And all I've been, you can do it. There's lots of ways you can do it, really. But what I do, so that's a 16 GPM, which is a great size hook for carp and that. And I just get the band. I'll put it on then show you because it's hard to do. And I just get the bottom of the band. Well, it's not the bottom of the band. This is a round band. And I just hook it through. I don't know if you can see that, Joe. Where is he? Is he coming into shot?
Up. Yes.
There he is. There, look. So I just hook it through the band like that, up a bit. See that? Right there. So that's actually up through the band. And I'll put a pellet on. Obviously, if you've got nails like I have, I just sort of grab out of the pellet at the top and then just push it around like that. There is a bit of a technique to that, but if you're not, use a pellet bander. And I normally have it sat on the hook, just like that. Like there. You can see that, everybody, if you can see that, look. And to be honest, for carp fishing, and it saves a lot of messing around. Mm. You know, if I want to put like a piece of worm on, that's the actual rig I was using yesterday. I've probably fished in like just over 2 foot, a 4B12. Anybody looking for a little margin float, shallow float, carp shallow like that are absolutely brilliant. You can't break them.
That is a great float, isn't it?
0.17 power line. I fished an 0.13 hook length. It was just come off the pre-tied mag store. Mm-hmm. But that was it. That's me little thing. Get asked quite a lot about that. You know, air rigging's great. I love it. You know, when you're fishing a waggler, feeder. But honestly, if you're doing carp fishing, just try the old school way.
That... Like Finn still does it. I think he does that and loads of angles I know, even tie line around them and stuff. And it's a brilliant way of doing it, isn't it?
It is, yeah. I used to actually super glue, before we got into all that, I used to actually super glue a piece of elastic band on the side.
I remember
side
seeing
of
that in magazines.
A lot of
Tony Rickson used to do that.
I actually done it before him.
Oh, here we go. Battle of the Southwest. That's what it used to be in the mags, isn't it?
No, it's not a battle of the Southwest. We've actually had that, and I beat him 3 times in 3 years. So that was not a battle. That was a wipeout. It was close on the last. That was all good for. That was all good because it was for
Air Ambulance, was it?
Air Ambulance. Yeah. So we had. That. I mean, actually, the last match I beat him, it was really close. I beat him by about £2, I think, and I caught nothing early, and I caught shallow on worm heads over casters at the end. And the air ambulance actually come into the field, right? We packed up and the air ambulance come in, literally 30, 40 metres away from where we were fishing, and come in to pick the check up. And as it landed, we were all just going over to them to have a chat and they had to take off because they went to an emergency. So,
doing its job, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a real good. It's a shame that we still don't do that. Mike, who owned the fishery at the time, I'll tell you who owns that fishery now is Gary Anderson.
Yeah, that's fair. I remember you saying that.
He's actually bought that fishery. So I'm sure Gary will spend, you know, a bit of his winnings.
And Flying Scotsman, of course.
Yeah, they're tight, aren't they? So I'm not sure what you're
doing. Can't be that tight. He bought a fishery.
If it's anything like Nicola Sturgeon, then there won't be a lot happening. But yeah.
I always remember the magazine articles like yourself and Tony and that dude, because at the time the only pellets anyone used by me in North Yorkshire was micros and expanders, and yeah. You lot are putting these 6mm pellets on, and we were like, nah,
what's going on? Yeah, well, I actually used to use catapult elastic, and it all started with my brother. That's where I don't know if I was the first to do it, but we were down Whiteacres fishing Sycamore Lake. I'm remember it because my young and Daniel was with us, and you only tiny. I got a picture of it in somewhere, and I was saying I can't remember what we were messing about with. And I said to Arvin, so I said, we need to put like a pellet on, a hard pellet. And he said, well, how are you going to get it on there? And I sat there, and I said, give us your catapult. And I took the end off, and I cut little slivers off, and it was bright pink. It was, I think it was like a adrenaline catapult at the time. And I said, put that around the pellet and put the hook over under it. And he was fishing and that's where it all sort of. Well, for me, that's where it all started. And I was obviously sat at home thinking, right, how can I get around this? I got elastic band, you know, glue them on, super glue them onto the side of the pellet. So you had a little tiny bit to put your hook in, but it was obviously a lot of messing about. And then all of a sudden the bands come out and
game changer, wasn't it?
It was the end of that, like. But yeah, that's where it all started from. But anyway, that's what I've been doing. For carp fishing, honestly, try it, because it's like going back up, it's like going back in time. But on the pole, it works very, very good. And it's nice because you don't have to set up lots of different rigs. You don't have to keep changing your hook length. So if you want to put a bit of corn on, you know, free maggots, worm heads or whatever, you can just smack the band off. And I think I probably caught 85, 90 pound yesterday, and I lost one band. And that was because Horacio flicked his head and the band come off.
Yeah. I'm
not just saying it, those size medium bands there for that sort of fish, something about them bands, they're just bloody right for that, and they're a bloody perfect size for air rigging casters and casters.
Yeah. Right, come on then, let's get on to the readers' questions, viewers' questions, listeners' questions. If you are feeder fishing in deep hooking bream, would you consider shortening the hook length?
I wouldn't worry too much about that as long as you're getting the bites off of the bream. I think that if they don't get caught a lot, I go to venues sometimes where you do get a bit of that, and I don't really worry about it. The only thing you've got to start worrying about is if you start pulling out of them, because what happens, a lot of bream in that you pull out of them because they're deep hooked. So what you do, you're obviously hooking them down a bit deep. And that's like and sometimes you know you're doing that because you come back and the hook will have a tiny little bit of white sort of like stuff on it. And that's probably like the throat of the fish, which ain't great for the fish, but anyway. But I wouldn't worry about it too much. The only thing is with like a method feeder, you never hook a bream that deep because obviously it is a short length. I wouldn't worry too much. I think if you started missing bites, you know, losing fish, then maybe shorten your hook length. But for me, with a normal feeder, I think a foot to 2 foot is about right. It's not very often I go below a foot, to be honest. I have done in a few occasions, but normally I find for normal feeder fishing, anywhere between a foot and 2 foot is about right, to be honest. I think 18 inches seems to be the optimum distance for like catching fish. And a foot is really good when you're probably missing bites, they're on the feeder, you know, you're struggling to catch them. You've got to mess about your mix a little bit more. You maybe put your ground bit in real firm. That's when you can bring your hook lengths down. But I don't think, don't worry about that. Don't worry about it. I, you know, some people I say to me on the pole, Des, I'm looking at a lot of fish deep hooked. Yeah, you can adjust your depth so small on the pole because it's so precise. We're on a feeder, it's a bit different. A fish could, you know, if you fish an even with a foot at length, you chuck your feeder in, it hits the bottom. In theory, your hook bait could land 1 inch from that feeder. So that bream can come along, take your hook bait, it can carry on feeding, which is probably what they're doing. And then they're like, oh, hello, what's that? And then they swim off. It just depends on the menu. Don't worry about it. Yeah. Unless you're losing a lot of fish.
Yeah. Yeah. I think most like bream anglers and that, a lot of the fish are quite deep hooked anyway, aren't they?
They do, yeah. Yeah, they do.
Sam Hanvey says, if you're fishing a snake type lake that's 16 meters wide where you target the bigger fish in spring, most of the time I seem to only catch the smaller fish across. How would you approach this, mainly carp and small F1s?
Well, it's like the place I fished, Acorn. That's a classic example. It's a very good fishery, to be fair. I mean, it depends on the fishery you're fishing. But normally, in springtime, it's worth starting across immediately. Now, that's always a gamble. You know, there's lots of different baits you can start. I always find in springtime, hard pellets take some beating or a big expander, but start on 4 mils. Don't go straight in on, it depends on where you draw as well. You know, if you draw in a real tough area, then you'll probably have to change pretty quick. But if I was going to a venue like that with carping, I'd probably start on just tapping a few 4 mils in and I'd soak them really, really lightly. So literally, you literally just put like a palm full of hand on a pint or two at 4 mils and just let them to start furring up on the edges. And I'd probably just tap like 8 or 10 of them in and go straight in either on a hard 6 mil or a 6 mil expander and try and get those fish that are probably panicking a little bit, because that's what they do on these canal style lakes. You can see it. There's some canal style lakes at Tewkesbury on Hillview. And you can just see them because the water goes really clear there. And you can see them bow waving around a little bit. Yeah, they're panicking because they all know you're trying to, you know, you're fishing. And you're trying to catch a few of them at the start. But then you might have to change. Then you might have to go to micros. Again, the nice thing in April time, I find, is there's not that many silverfish feeding. They're a little bit funny. They're, you know, the perch ain't feeding. The roach are a bit like weird. So you can like start fishing. Make sure this thing switched on the power. Yeah. And that's where you can sort of go to micros and fish different hook baits. You can fish meat, corn, you know, free maggots, bits of worm. But I would always have 1 ground bait and 2 some dead maggots. Because if it's a match situation, you're going into the last hour and a half, you've been back over and it ain't really happening, you've got to go for it. You've got to put some bait in. Because them fish will be going up and down off the bottom. They're not really interested. You can't catch them shallow. You might have an odd foul looker. We all get that. You know, they're not feeding. And that's when you can bite the bullet with an hour and 40 to go and say, right, I'm going to put 3/4 of a pot of maggots or micros in, depending on who you're on. But never write off ground bait. You know, even though that water is still cold, you can still put a big pot of ground bait in, especially if you can get in shallow water. Them carp are unbelievable this time of year. You get any sun and they're straight up. So you've now got to start looking to get into like a foot of water. You might not catch there until that last 45 minutes, but believe you me, you might be the only one it does it, is put like a big pot of ground bait in and you can have a bloody good last 40 minutes or so right over in shallow water. And that's how I would approach a snake lake for carp this time. It's no different to what I've been doing. I'm normally pleasure fishing at the moment, unfortunately, but that's what I would be doing. I'd be holding back my volume of bait until the last hour and 45 minutes, really.
Yeah, so it's worth just staying in the match with them smaller fish if you can catch them, isn't it?
Yeah. Just have them expanders with you. Because honestly, I went down last Saturday and you could catch on hard pellets and it was great when they're having a little go. And all of a sudden, it's a bit funny. I like, right, put a 6 mil expander on. Wallop. You're catching like Carassio, F1s, the odd carp. They just, you know, they're not, they've just gone a bit funny. You would get a bite on a hard pellet, but you get twice as many, well, you catch twice as fast on a soft pellet.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. That's the difference you need. When it's hard pellet fishing, they're having it, it's easy because you can strike, you miss it, you're straight back in fish, you don't have to shit back. So that's the sort of, that's the way I would be approaching a snake lake in springtime, April time now. Mm-hmm. Nice. Hopefully I can prove this next Tuesday.
Yeah, nice. Let's hope so. Funny enough, Average Angler's on the open at Acorn next week, Tuesday, and he says, do you think hard pellets will work in the match?
100%. 100%. I think if you draw the right area, I think half the lake will be really good, and I think the other half, you'll have to fish it differently. Mm-hmm. You might have to start on hard pellets, then a few soft pellets. If it ain't happening, you might have to just change and just think, well, I've got to catch everything that swims until that last hour and 45. And then, you know, you either catch down the edge or you catch across if there's a few carp about. But yes, I will be looking to fish hard in soft pellet in that match, without a doubt. 100%.
Nice. Mark Richmond, good afternoon, gents. Love the show. Do you think enough has been done to protect our waters, particularly rivers, as regards predation, cormorants, otters, etc.?
No, Mark. I think we're in big trouble. My honest opinion. I know I probably will upset a few people. And it's really weird that I was out here at Melksham the other day, and a woman come along, and there was a cormorant up in the tree. And obviously he's living there. He's obviously going up and down the river every morning, every evening. And I was chatting to her, and she's a real nice woman. She works for the council. She's like taking some pictures of the cormorants. And I said, you know, just chatting to her about it. And it's a lot of people, unless you're an angler, don't really understand the damage that is happening.
It's a shame because if the damage has been done to sheep in a field or whatever, they'd be outcry, wouldn't they?
I think we got a massive problem. And listen, I look at it in both ways. It's like, I mean, the cormorants are a problem, but the otters are a massive problem. They are a massive problem. And it's not just for fishing. I think it's just for bird life in everything. I don't worry, you want to cause a load of grief because it all gets a bit muddled up, doesn't it? And I will go back to, I watch the Spring Watch. And I watch that program every year, and I think it's really good seeing it all. Mm. And I think it was the very last one I watched. It was, they're in Scotland. And obviously, this is the way I look at all this. Over the last 15 years or so, the Environment Agency have put a lot of work into trying to reintroduce salmon, eels, back into their spawning grounds. So the eels, they put those climbing frames in by the weirs, et cetera, trying to get the elvers back up. They've obviously cut the elvers. People catching the elvers, they've obviously on limit, you know, they can only limit it now. And then obviously they've got the salmon runs in to try and get the salmon back into the rivers. And it's obviously been quite successful. And I watched Spring Watch the other week, and they had an otter eating a salmon. They had an otter eating a sea trout. Had a cormorant eating a trout, and they had a goose and they had an otter eating a salmon, an otter eating a trout. This is obviously from the same river, I think. Mm. They had a cormorant eating a 3-pound salmon, which I just could not believe at that, you know. Mm. And then they had a goose sander eating a trout, and I thought that happens every single day, 365 days a year. That river cannot
sustain it.
It can't do it. You've got the anglers. You've got everything else that's going on. That cannot sustain that. So all the work that's been done, I know I'm off the track here.
It's not bad. You're not.
All the work that people have done now is being affected. I think is going to be affected massively. And I keep saying to people, make the most of these big fish in the river. I remember Martin Bowler, it was a fair few years ago. So if Martin's listening, if you are listening, you're probably not, because he's probably out in Thailand or something. Get on here, because I remember they interviewed Martin Bowler in Bath, and I used to fish that area called the Cabbages in Worley and Limpy Stoke, and it used to be Solomon Barbel. And he was
not there now, are they?
He was being interviewed, and he said, and this was a long time ago, this was years and years ago, and he said, this river is decimated now with barbel. And
he mentions it quite a bit, and he's because he does his Instagram things, and he's saying that the Avon's just gone now.
I don't want to upset anything, but I just think the rivers. Listen, you only got to look at it this way. Woodlands View has just put an
otter. We were just there last week, weren't we?
We were there last week. It's cost him 20, it's probably cost him 50, 60 grand to put our fence around. Yeah. He's doing that because he's protecting his fishery. Mm. Every fishery in this country needs to put an otter fence around their lake. Because
yep.
If they don't, it's going to get
there. Ain't even a river anywhere near, is there? Woodland View.
We can't, unfortunately, we can't do that on rivers. We can't do that on rivers, and we can't do that on canals.
I think I mentioned it before, but you know, when I was chubbing on the Neen, and if I ever went in the evening, you never saw one. You wouldn't even know there was one there. But if I went in the morning, and I wasn't getting there particularly early, 8 o'clock sort of time, I'd see one every single time. And they're in a little pool.
I don't really know what the solution is. I mean, it's happened, and that's it. But it's it's one of them. But
you see an otter, and I presume there's a family of them in a little weir pool that probably only holds 20 big fish at best. They're going to get ripped through that in no time, aren't they?
As I said, people.
And then fish are probably 30 years old. Then fish.
You've got to look at it this way: they're there every single day for 6 days a year.
Yeah.
They can no fishery in the world. Can sustain that. Anyway, that's enough.
No, the answer is no.
yeah.
Please, could you show us how to tie a figure of eight knot, please?
Figure of eight knot, right. Now, if you don't, I don't use them, but if you can use a loop tire, and they're really, really good, but it's the same principle. So what you start off with is your piece of line like that. I think get that into shot, Joe. What if I turn that light on? I better shine up a bit. Is that going to help? No, it's not. Is it? So you start off with your line like that. You bring that round. So you create a loop. So you basically got doubled over a piece of line like that. And then you bring that round again, which creates a circle. And you've got the little bit stuck up at the end, which is like your tag end, but it's doubled over. Now, what I do, you have to twist that circle that you've created. Now, the way I do that is I actually turn my hands round, and that all that does is actually cross the loop in the middle. Now, this bit here, this tag end, needs to go through the bottom of that crossover. And then that creates your figure of eight. That is as simple as that. Now, if you want to do a double, I don't do doubles. I just do singles. I think Joe told Joe about it, and Joe's been doing singles.
No, I used to be a double guy because Alan used to be like, and then as soon as you told me that, I was like, that's me.
That is it. And I obviously, if you want to make it a certain size, I got a little tool in here. That's a little quorum tool. I don't know if they still make them. It's like a loop sizer. There's lots of different things. Preston do a...
Yeah, we do a loop sizer.
Where is he? He's in here somewhere.
Sorry, I had one, but I've been doing some close-up stuff.
Where is he? That's what I keep saying to my cat in the morning. Where is he when he's looking for a mouse? But yeah, basically, Preston do like a little, they got different sizes. I can't find one. A bit of a pain. But yeah, anyway, they're peanuts. They're peanuts to buy. And then what you do then, so you do that. You double it over like that. Always lick it because it keeps the line together. Bring that over, which creates a circle with a double tag end. I call it a double tag end stuck at the top. Then you have to turn this circle, you have to turn. I do that. As long as that's like crossed over in the middle, so it's like a figure of eight when you look at it from where I'm looking at it. And then that double tag end goes through the bottom of the turnover. It's got to go through the bottom, and it's got to go through the back. If you put it through the front that way instead of that way, it'll come out as a different knot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's it. That's a figure of eight. Job done. Best knot ever for what I do in my fishing anyway. So I hope that clears it up. But if not, use a loop tire. I don't use them because I like a slightly bigger loop.
Robert Williams, he's recently bought a 420 inertia, and when he winds in, it feels a bit stiff. Is there anything I can do so it's free running again, or do I need to return it to where I bought it?
Well, normally... I mean, that's a 520 there, an inertia. And it spins easy. So if it's not really spinning like that, then obviously you need to take it back, unless you've dropped it or something, which I don't think you probably have.
No.
But no, really.
It certainly shouldn't be stiff.
No, the only thing I would try is maybe putting it near a radiator for a night. Put it on a radiator, warm it up, because there just might be some grease in the actual cogs itself. So it might be worth, even if you put it on top of a radiator for 15 minutes, and it might just get everything like loosened up. Cause obviously if it's been really cold and you've been fishing with it, the grease in there can go a bit like hard, like any sort of grease really in cold weather. So it might just be worth trying that, see what happens. If not, take it back to your shop.
Yeah, definitely.
Might be something not quite right. Yeah, but if it's not, you know, if it's not flying around like that, you know, you see that.
Yeah.
That's a 520, eh?
Yeah, it should be doing that.
Take it back to your job, yeah.
Anthony Waring, as a person who works shifts, how do you balance work and match fishing on a daily or monthly basis? That is, how far in advance would you bait prep and tackle prep to make sure you're on the right day?
Well, I used to do the same, Anthony. I used to work continental shifts. I've worked all sorts of different shifts. I've worked 12-hour nights. I've worked double days, whatever. You name it, I've probably done it. And I used to finish work. Obviously, it's difficult. It's not easy. Bait-wise, ain't too bad. I mean,
especially nowadays.
Yeah, it's quite simple, isn't it, really? You can go and get your bait whenever. Just double stock up on your ground bait and your pellets. Make sure you don't have to keep going up to the shop. In advance, really, I just think you've got it's a couple of days. As long as you give your shop a couple of days for casters, most tackle shops probably get their bait delivered on a Thursday, Friday, and maybe a Tuesday. So you try and get fresh bait in between. As for rigs and that, I think when you're on shift work, I used to get like quite a lot of time. If I was on earlies, I used to finish at 2:30. I should get home, and then if you could, if your missus allows you, go in the garage. And I always say, if you've got a nice selection of rigs, a nice selection of hooks that you're happy with, you know, you're happy with everything. I know we try and tell you everything that we do, but keep on top of it. Mm. You know, if you go fishing on like Saturday and Sunday, just try and redo those rigs, especially if you're going to different venues. It don't really matter if you're going to the same venue because, yeah, you know, you'll probably get away with them. But just stay on top of it. Mm. You know, and do the same, like I do, I use the same float, but with different main lines. So it keeps it nice and simple. I'm happy with me floats. You know, I've got a selection of the slims, and I've got a selection of like the shallows. I've got some diamonds. I can do so much. That covers me for so much of my fishing on commercials. It's untrue. And then obviously, you know, I go on rivers and that, which ain't happening at the moment. I've got a little selection of floats for that. And just try and stay on top of it and use good quality stuff. You know what I mean? Make sure, and we spoke about it. I spoke about this the other day with Tony from Improve about what silicone you put on floats. Mm. You know, make sure it's good quality. Make sure it's the right size so you don't have to mess around with it. Just little things like that. Just make sure everything's like top notch, you know?
Yeah.
And that's it, really. Just try and keep on top of it because it does get behind sometimes. I've done it. I mean, I've sold that. I can't be bothered this week. And you go fish, you think, Jesus Christ, I wish I'd just give myself an hour.
Once you have that base of stuff, topping it up and putting two and three rigs together in evenings, easy, isn't it? When you've got to do like 10 or 12, it becomes an issue, isn't it?
Stick with the same floats, Anthony. Honestly, stick with the F1 maggots and things like that. You can use them from 011 mainline to 019 if you want to. And they're a good all-round float. You know, if it gets windy, then you might want like a round body float if it's real nasty. But honestly, that's what I do. It's like these little carp shallows. If you really wanted to, you could use them for all, like your margin, island fishing, shallow fishing,
carp, mugging. And
maybe F1s, you probably want an F1 shallow. But they're so versatile. That's why we've done them. They're so.
If you had an F1 maggot and that in your box,
wouldn't go far wrong.
For a lot of fishing there, aren't you?
Yeah, there's so many people that I've taken coaching. I'll get her in the morning. I've said this before. I said, right. And I let them make a decision. I say, right, what are you going to use today? And there's no point in me saying, well, that's what you want. Because I want to see what they do. And they open their box and they're like, well, what do you reckon then, Des? And I'm like, well, what do you reckon? They're like, well, I don't know. What do you reckon? They just all these different floats. With, you know what I mean? And we all have that.
Yeah, of course we do.
But for you personally, I think if you just stick with a few floats, that takes a lot of the grief out of the amount of prep you've got to do.
Yeah, I agree.
Fine.
I agree. Mark Caton says, no, he's asking a factors question. Oh, sorry, okay. Go on, we'll answer it, because Jake's not on today. It says, would you use the new green factors on the feeder? Think it would go really well with micros. Keep up the great work, guys.
100%. I mean, it's like I've done the little video with Jake the other day, and we've obviously, at the moment...
It's a lovely ground bait, isn't it?
It is beautiful.
And they've got the green bang on, haven't they? They've got the green bang on. Yeah, sometimes green, it's a bit green, tricky.
Yeah, we obviously with the EU regulations now, we've got to, and it's not just us; it's every bait company and a lot of different companies have got to. Even though we've left the EU, you've still got to sell a product in the EU now. You can't use everything's got to be like a vegetable based, natural based colouring, and that's created problems. But we've got it right. I mean, it's been a long winded thing, but there you go. Ian Itson, who's done a great job as per normal. I think that will play a part in my fishing without a doubt. I do like green ground baits, but I think on the feeder and that, I think it'd be absolutely bang on. You know, that mix, you stick it in a bucket and use it, and that's it, personally.
Yeah.
Anywhere where it's that greeny coloured water,
I love green ground baits.
Be absolutely deadly anywhere.
Green fishing.
When I got that the other day, I'm actually waiting for some stuff. I literally only got the bag off of Jake the other day. I ain't got any left, mate. And I could just see me using that anywhere where I go. F1 fishing, you know, on like Tunnel Barn, so many places. I just use green.
Green, yeah, it's a great color, isn't it? Great color all around.
It's just how I think we all know Fatters has been really successful. Even before Sonu produced it, and it's just one of their mixes. It's just heavy, it's nice, it's easy, and that's what we all want, really.
It's really good ground bait, isn't it? It's so good. Lee Sparrow says, this is quite a funny one, what are the best fishing compliments you could pay to each other? Well, I'm going to blow smoke up your ass. You're just good, aren't you?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think
you're pretty good at fishing, aren't you?
Well, I do try. I don't, you know, it's like my brother has always said to me, Des, you've just got a knack. You've just got a knack of sitting there and, like, catching more fish.
You know what I like about you when I watch you fish? There's nothing fancy. Do you know what I mean? It's not, there's no, like, big theories or anything like that. You just fish and read the swim every time. And you keep it simple, but you've got lots of things going on. It just blows my mind every time how simple you are. But
there is lots of bits. There's lots really of things going in my mind, I do try and keep it simple in a certain way with rigs and hooks and things like that, elastics.
You keep a lot of swims going, don't you?
Yeah, that's the difference with me is I do have several swims going, but I might not use them, but they're always there just in case I think, well, actually, this has gone a bit quiet. Let me just nip in there a minute. Sometimes you make your own luck, I would say. It's not luck, but you make your own luck.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can feed the line all day, go in and get a bite, and you think, oh, Christ almighty, what a waste of time that was. But there's a lot of matches when you think, I'll go in there and you're fishing, you know, whatever you decide to do on a couple of throwaway lines, and you get a few fish, and also you get a bonus this and a bonus that, and also that line turns into like the match winning line now, you know?
And you often like fish, you know, you will actually have a silver's swim, even in a kart match, and just to give yourself an extra 10-15 pound at the end, don't you, and stuff like that.
So the times at White Acres, maybe not so much now, but back in the day, you know, it's a be in the arm, and I draw in the arms a lot at White Acres on the match day on Halloween Lake.
And it used to be good fishing, to be fair, didn't it?
It used to be brilliant. I used to fish a top kit down the edge. I used to just throw casters in there, and you could go in there and you could catch rope, and all of a sudden, you go in there, it's like, whoa, hello, carp, £4, wallop, bream, you know, and then you think, oh, I'll put a bit of ground bait in there. Next bit, it's a wallop, bream, carp, wallop, and they're like on a top kit. And then you weigh in, and you've caught like £40 of silvers, and, you know, you've ended up with like £80, and you've won the section. The times that has won me that section, and second in the section, and won me the festival, I'd lose count. But that, and it don't always happen. And there is times I come away from venues, and I think I shouldn't even have done that today. I shouldn't have done it because it was a pointless. I should have just fished out and out, like for big fish, sat there nice and patient on a lump of meat or whatever. But the trouble is with me, I always look at the negative fish. It's like the match I put some up the other day when I caught a carp on the River Soar. Right, and that was it was brilliant for me, but I always think more about the bream that I lost before I caught that carp, because I was so angry and I mean proper, I mean the top five went up in the air and everything, because I blanked the previous day, like most people around, well, everybody around me. And now I've gone to a peg this Sunday where no one's had a bite, and I've lost this bream. Yeah, and that bream sticks in my mind more than that carp. And that's, but that's the way I am. I always look at the negative. I remember Steve Ringer beating me in the, I don't know what year he won it. He won the Park Dean. And Ben Leach come running up to me after the match, and he said, "You've won it." I said, "Well, how do you know?" He said, "Well, no one else has caught anything." He said, "The only person that beat you was Steve Ringer." And I said, "All right." And I looked round, and Steve Ringer's playing a carp. So the whistle's virtually gone. Right, and he's playing a carp, and the tail's coming in like that. He's looking at the tail. And I said to Ben Leach, I said, "If he gets that out, he'll beat me." And he beat me by £2. This carp was about £4.5. But, and that, even though I've won it like three times.
Yeah, haunts you.
That haunts me more than anything else. And that's the way I am. I always look, you know, so, but that's me. Anyway, what was the question?
Says, what's the best fishing compliments you could pay each other? So we're just blowing smoke up your ass, Des. I'm just a chub angler.
I think you just go up and say, "Well done." I think you just go up to, and I'll tell you what's happened nowadays is it's funny that it's changed. People get angry. I do. I mean, I'm a bad loser, and I know that. I know that deep inside, and I think everybody knows that.
You're a terrible loser.
I think to go up to a person or as they're weighing in and you're watching and say, "Well done, mate, that's brilliant." And I get that a lot. You know what I mean? I get that a lot. And I think that's the best compliment that you can give anyone. Even if they haven't won, if he's done well from a good, you know, a crap area, and that's when you get your respect, is when you've actually probably done something a bit different and you go up to him after and say, "Fair play, mate. That is... you've done brilliant there." Even though you can't win, you know, from where you've been, it's been bloody brilliant.
Yeah.
And that, I think that's it. You just say, "Well done." You know. It's not all about winning.
If you can't win on most of the pegs you draw.
No.
That's unless, you know, very rare venues, it's like that, isn't it? Where you can win off most pegs.
Yeah.
Right. Grumpy Grandad says, "I have purchased some of your 4x16 diamonds for deep and windy venue. Depth varies from 5 to 14 foot. Should I shot with a standard bulk and two droppers, mainly for big carp?"
Yeah. If 4x16s, yeah, 4x16s, I would just have 2 number 9 droppers. If it was really deep, I mean, my normal shotting pattern is obviously you do your loop on your main line, where your hook length goes on. I normally put a shot or a stop there. On a 4x16, it would be a number 9. And then I normally go about 5 inches above that, I'd do my second number 9. And then 6 inches above that, I start the bulk. If it's really deep, Grumpy, I would spread that just a little bit further out. That's the way I work.
It's nicer, so isn't it?
It's just nicer. You get a bit more of a drop on it. It looks right when you're shipping out. You're not going to get tangles. But anywhere from like 4 to 7 foot, like I said, number 9, 5 inches, number 9, 6 inches of your bolt. Once you start going over sort of 7 foot, I would probably have like the first number 9 and then 8 inches and then like 9 inches to your bulk. That's what I would do. I think it just looks right. It goes in nice and you don't get tangles or twisting. But I'd have like number 9, and your bulk would be number 8. So that's where we use shot or stops. And that would be it. But you probably, I think we'd do a 4x18. If you start fishing in deep water, you want some 4x18s in them as well.
Definitely want a couple of them.
Yeah, when I go to White Acres and fish on the, like, Halloween on the Max Lake, on the high bank, you need a 4x18 on there.
Yeah.
Because it is like, it's over a top kit. It's probably 9 foot. And you definitely need a 4x18, especially if there's a little bit of tow and a bit of wind on it.
Yeah. David Holford says, why are the carp pellet rigs missing banded hooks? Especially an issue as you can't buy replacement 6-inch hook clamps with bands. Well, we're working on that. We have got a bit of news on that eventually.
Yeah, we are working on that. It is a problem. I mean, we are trying to get something dead right, not just for you, but for the shops as well. But we are working on it, desperately working on it. It's been in the pipeline for too long, really. But yeah.
Are you there?
Yeah.
Sorry, you cut off then.
Did I lost you? Did I lose you there?
It's all right.
There's actually a lorry just pulled up here. It's making a bit of noise. I don't know if you can hear it. No. But yeah, we are working on it. It is a problem. It is annoying. Just bear with us, basically. You know, But if you're carp fishing, doing what I done yesterday, I'll tell you now, it takes some beating.
Yeah, definitely. Especially and obviously, we put them with a hook on, just a straight hook, so they're more versatile, don't we, at the end of the day?
Yeah, we do, yeah.
What's going on here?
Oh my goodness. Never even asked.
Brilliant service, that, isn't it?
I give her a right good bollocking the other week, and I think, no, I didn't. She doesn't watch this anyway, so I won't get into trouble, but probably someone will tell her.
She probably can hear you.
No, that door's pretty damn good, to be honest.
Right, Cameron McKenzie says, I've tried the new PowerScope X Haze and 6mm wafter yesterday for the first time and landed two nice commons. Very happy with that. Well done, Cameron. Good
brilliant
stuff.
Cameron, well, mate. Spot on. I've had a few good comments, actually, about the new product.
Scopex is lovely, isn't it?
Yeah, I've had a
bit. Beautiful.
No one else had a bite on the lake, and he's put a bit of bait booster on the new Scopex, and he's had two carp, and no one's had a bite. So
nice. Good work.
It's nice. And that's what's so nice about new products, is you can go somewhere like that, and because it's new, it's something that carp ain't seen before,
You've
got a damn good chance of catching, which is what it's all about.
Yeah, I agree. David Edwards says, I'm reelasticating my pole and I've got 4 F1 tops, 12 power tops and 3 match tops. What shall I get as I fish commercial and natural waters?
Run through the top kits again.
Right, 4 F1 tops.
Is that top twos or short stops?
I think he just means short stops.
Well, if it's short stop, what's his name again?
David.
David. Well, if it's short stops, David, and you... Because obviously you'd be fishing for F1s then. I would go for a 9. You have to excuse the lorry reversing. I would go for a 9 Jura slip. I think that'd be perfect. You could have 2 9s and 2 11s.
Mm-hmm.
But to be honest, if you're F1 fishing, just go for 9s. I think it's absolutely perfect. I honestly do. It's a lovely elastic. You know, and unless you're bagging, then if you're going to somewhere and they're big, big F1s, then maybe go up to 11. But stick with 9s to start with and see how you get on. What's the other ones he's got, Joe?
He's got 12 power kits.
12? Well,
big spender.
Power kits, I would definitely go. I would have 4 13s straight away. Even if 5, to be honest. Because they're so good at all sorts of fishing. Even if you're fishing for big F1s on the deck or down the edge, you can use that. I used it yesterday and I caught Carassio, F1s. Obviously, you look at a big carp and it was perfect. So I would go 4 or 5 white 13 Jura slips. And then I'd probably have a couple of 11s. Because that's like a happy medium elastic. You know, if you're going somewhere and you're fishing for F1s on the bottom, you know, you might catch the odd carp. That's the nice thing about 11 is if you go into an out-and-out F1 venue, fish on the bottom, fish 11, you know, you got your 9s for shallow because you don't want it a bit. I think you just want it a little bit less for fishing shallow. You can have like, if you had like 5 13s, 3 number 11s. So that's, what's that? 5's 8.
8.
And I'd have a couple of 15s and a couple of 17s. I think that'd be, in my old order, that's what I got is like that. It'd be absolutely bang on. Yeah. But if you're not going nowhere and it's crazy fishing, if stick with those 13s. I got like 6 13s, and that tells you something. I can use them against islands, down the edge, shore. As long as you're not bagging. If I'm going to somewhere like Stafford Moor, for instance, and I know they're proper hard fighting fish and they do fight crazy some places, then I'd go up to 15 for fishing down the edge and short, but long I'd be fishing 13 up and down for them carp. So if not, you could go to 6, you know, 6 13s. I know it sounds crazy, but honestly, when you use that elastic, you'll be struck into what you use anything else. So I think 5 13s, couple of 11s, and then fill the other ones up with a couple of 15s and a couple of 17s for like your edge fishing when it's proper big fishing, it's solid.
What about his 3 match kits for natural venues?
Match kits for natural fishing. It depends on whether you want to use the new Jura slip or whether you want to use the original. I still love the original, which is something I've used. If you just stick with 6s, honestly, you can't go wrong. It is a great elastic. You know, you can do 2. There it is there. You can do 2 top kits. Make sure it's the original slip. Make sure you use the a bit of snag on it. The Jura snag. Shouldn't have said that, really.
I enjoy it. I like it.
That sort of mood. But use that on it. Use it on all that Jura slip and the original slip. You cannot beat it. But make sure, like I did yesterday, I spray like 3 times on each section when the section's apart. And I get there and I do that in the lake water. So it just makes it go up and down the section. Because a few people have said to me, Des, I love that stuff, but it clogs in me pole. And I think if you put it in there and it's a real hot day, you don't put a bit of water down up and down your pole, it ain't no good. You need to put a bit of lake water in, shake it about a bit and put it on your head. And when you pack away, that's it. It's job done for next time.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Right, Martin Hassel asks this question every week. And
yes.
It's about a midi feeder. And he says, where do you put the line through? Now, I can't for the life of me remember what that feeder even looks like, Martin, which is why...
Not a shotgun feeder, is it?
Yeah, it's a shotgun, but it's a new one. And he says there's 2 tubes on it. I would go in... I'd go through whichever one you think's right, Martin. There's.
Only time I've ever used one of them was about probably 15 years ago at Larford.
Hmm.
And that was like the old ones. I can't remember how that used to go on, to be honest.
No, I can't. I honestly can't remember. That's not me just fobbing you off. And he said, when it comes to rods, is the 9-foot feeder, 9-foot feeder rods, is the ignition the only option, or do you do more premium ones?
No, we do a 9-foot ignition, which is obviously one you know about, and we do a 9-foot Sapira.
Yeah, and a monster.
The 9-foot Sapira, like I've said about all the Sapira rods, they are more of a classy. More crisp action rod, so they'll be better for casting, a little bit stiffer playing fish. So if you're catching more carp, I would say the Sapira is probably, you know, if you want to cast a bit longer with a 9-foot rod and you want a crisper action rod, the Sapira. And the monster fits in the middle of both of them. The monster is not so crisp as the Sapira and not quite as soft as the ignitions. And that's what you pay your money for. But I love the ignition because it's got that soft action, which I love. I love it. I don't, you know, especially when you're starting to catch Carassio, you don't know what you're going to hook next. They're bloody, well, you know, I used the old Tyson on the Park Dean Masters.
Yeah.
I lost 1 Carassio all day. Now, wherever you say that was the rod, the hook, the day, the feed, I don't know.
It's not just about that day, though, is it? I mean, like, when you, at that time, you was going top of manor every week and catching loads on the method, and you was literally catching £300 every week on that rod.
Yeah, on a 9-footer. Yeah. And it just suited what I was doing. And they were these little jaggedy little carp. At Tobber, they literally, you hook them, you get them back, and then they start, like, jumping out of the water while you're keeping it. They're like, what is that? It's like the line goes over their back, and they're like, whoa. I'm like, what the hell? And then the feeders obviously banks up. I've tried elasticated. I've tried inline. Elasticated definitely seems to be a little bit better, but everybody has the same. But using that rod just give me, I think, like a big percentage of getting them out. So,
yeah.
But you won't go far wrong with the ignitions. If you want to spend the money, a little bit more aggressive action than the Sapira.
Yeah. Steve Smith says, love the Q&A sessions. I'm fishing the Sonia Bates Veterans Match in August at Packington Summers. Any tips would be welcome, as I've never fished there before. I've fished there quite a lot, Packington.
Yeah, there's a lot of lakes, isn't there?
That's the thing. You've got to go and fish how you want to fish there, because there's so much you can do. If you look at the results, people win on the Waggler, they win on the Method, they win on the Bomb, they win on the Long Pole, they win on the Short Pole, they win on Meat, Paste, flying places. You know, it's not necessarily a big weight place, is it, Packington?
I would say... If you draw, you'll be unlikely to... Well, there is some lakes without islands, but anywhere you've got an island...
Yeah, you're going to have some sort of feature, aren't you?
You'll have a method stroke pellet feeder.
Mm-hmm.
It might be worth starting on a pellet feeder.
Does work well there.
Work well on that venue, but change over to a method. You might not even come off the pellet feeder if the fishing's good.
Mm.
One thing is, on molems especially, because the island has been at away over a long period of time, the shelf comes on, not on every peg, but I know on some pegs, the shelf comes a long way off.
It can be really shallow tight, can't it?
Really shallow. So you can actually fish. You just chuck your empty feeder out to start and count them down. You can actually come off the island quite a bit and have a brilliant day's fishing.
Yeah.
know, have the option of coming off. No, don't just keep chucking tight.
When I was going there a lot, you know, I used to actually plumb it up. I used to put a set of float like that deep and chuck it to spots spots, because some places you think, bloody hell, that looks good. And when you actually fish there, it's like that deep.
Yeah, I've had them tailing up there and you can't catch them.
Yeah, it's too shallow.
You catch some, but you're pulling your air out where you should be. And you've just come off a couple of meters and you get one every chuck.
Yeah, I've had that a few times.
But casting regularly, 100%. Because in MF1s, I can't say what I want to say. Beep, beep. They are like that some days. Yeah, big. They are wise.
Thing you've got to say about that lake as well, especially Molland. You've got to be patient. You get your runs of fish, because the F1s are huge, aren't they?
And the carp, there's some...
Yeah.
Carp in there.
It's a hard lake, that Molland's, in match conditions.
On the pole, personally, I think the long pole is really tricky on that venue.
Short pole's good, though, in the summer.
Aren't they? They're really tricky to fish. If I was fishing on there, I think...
Funny depth there, isn't it? It's like 8-9 foot.
Yeah, it's a funny one. I think, personally, I wouldn't ignore meat.
Mm, I'd fish meat on a short pole.
I fish meat long and short on the pole, unless it's an out and out sort of shallow day. I think you won't go far wrong priming your pole lines up with just a little bit of meat, throwing it short and catapulting it, and maybe potting a little bit long at like 13 meters. And then down the edge, I think if it's summertime, you can't ignore ground bait with dead maggots. Keep it simple.
Yeah. And then obviously on like, big gear is totally different, because it's open water, big carp fishing.
Bomb and pellet, method over the top.
Yeah, and long pole hard pellets, they catch a lot on that as well. So
yeah,
but these one of them places, it's like every lake's a bit different, so it's a bit of a tricky one. But if you do what you like, enjoy doing, you'll be all right. Can hair loops or quick stops be manually tied onto spade end hooks?
They can.
I don't do it.
I know the Dennis who done the hook.
He did an attachment, didn't he?
He done an attachment, and he did actually come to my house. I've done some film with Tom Scully, and Dennis showed me, and I'm like, I can't remember it. I've never done it, but you can do it. You can do it. You need to tie hooks by hand to do it. Really, if you don't, if you use a machine. Apart from what Dennis done, ZT Pro, isn't it? It's what they called.
ZT Pro.
Gizmo Anglin done some tools. I don't know if he's still in business now. I don't know. But he done a little tool that you put on that hook tire and you can do spade end hooks with a rapid stop or bands. But I personally don't do them. Air rigging for me is all about eye hooks.
Yeah, that's the advantage of trying to do it with a spade, to be fair. It seems like a bit of a fiddly job, that. When casting a feeder and hitting the clip, the feeder sometimes bounces back. What am I doing wrong?
Well, that's an art. That is something that a lot of people cannot grasp. And you've got to go out and practice it. You have to go out and practice and practice and practice. Even if you go out for a few hours on an evening, go to an island peg and cast out. And a lot of that is where it's a tricky one, because if it's windy and you've got to cast, like give it some force to get it there because of the wind, you're feeding the object, because what you want to do is like cast, but sort of cast enough pressure to get it there, but not enough where you go like that and it all bounces back. And that's practice. But normally it's like a suspension system. What you've got to do is, as your feeder's getting near your clip, you've got your rod at this angle, especially if you're forcing it, and you sort of, as it hits the clip, you sort of follow it. That's what you've got to do. That's the art of it.
It's that little timing, isn't it? That little moment.
It is such a fine line from getting your feeder to come back at you. I mean, listen, I do it a lot, and I think, oh, you beep. You know what I mean? Didn't quite get that right then. But that's something you've just got to practice, and you've got to try and get your rod back. But it's like, as you hit the clip, it's a millisecond of you following it. But you always get that little bit. You don't see it until people like Joe do slow-mo on filming. Then if you watch I'll tell you where I actually seen it was I was out with David Hall. Unfortunately, he's not with us anymore. He was.
Remember it.
I was at Woodlands View, and it was the first time Sonia Bates was born.
We'd done
Match Method Mix video, and he was sat there. It was a lovely day, and Mike.
Had the brogues on, didn't he?
Yeah, he let us use Match Method Mix on. It was one of the new lakes with the F1s.
In Barley, wasn't it?
In Barley. And that was when, like, the 10-foot rod was developed for that sort of style of fishing with Preston. The Method feeders, obviously the plastic ones, not the metal ones. The ICS wasn't around then. And I remember, I think Dave Weston done the filming. And he went over on the far bank, and I watched the film back. And that was only a little and little chucks are harder sometimes.
Yeah, they are.
And you could see the feeder going, like, that far from the mud. And you see the trail bubbles come about two foot back.
Do you know, it's funny. When I was a kid, me and Adam Richards must have watched that 100 times and we were like, see, it's not going anywhere near the fab.
That to me, I knew then that I need to buffer that situation.
Hmm.
And you have to have your rod. It depends where you draw. It depends. It depends on the distance. But you've just got to practice it and understand it. And we will be doing some filming on that this year. Hopefully, and we will explain that more. But you're not doing nothing wrong. It's just having your rod back, and you've got to buffer it. Think of it like a suspension, it's just buffering, aren't you? You're buffering the line because you've got the line stretch as well.
Tell you what's a good one, actually. On the DVD last year, it's on YouTube, Andy Finley's section, the Method Feeder Masterclass. He does a whole segment in this. And to be fair, he makes it look easy. He makes it look like it's in slow-mo, doesn't he, Finn? And it's worth watching that because he explains it perfectly and how he follows it in.
It's such a fine line because you want to keep your tight. You want to keep the line tight. So when it goes in, everything's dead tight. So you sink your line quick. But you also want it to go in not too tight that you spring your feeder back. Your feeder always comes back a bit. I'll tell you that for nothing. There's 100%. Unless it goes in like a torpedo and then your bait's off anyway. Yeah. You know, if it goes in like that, you've not quite hit the clip. That goes in, I call it the torpedo effect, because you get a trail of bubbles. I've been battered by people that do that.
You see that with the old carp anglers, don't you, sometimes? Yeah, the leads out, it's like, boom.
Yeah, like, zoom, and those are like, oh, that was, I'm like, Jesus Christ. But, you're not doing nothing wrong, you just need that timing just to get it right. It's like Joe said, have a look at Finley's thing.
Yeah, definitely. Well, he definitely does a real nice section on that.
He's pretty good at all that, old Finn.
He is, yeah, not half. Ryan Ogden says, can you show us how to connect rigs to Dacron connectors? You did this last week and we've done it on a beginner's guide to pole fishing, so check them out.
Yeah.
Craig Miller says, I'm fishing the Fisho qualifier at Moorlands next Saturday. Any tips on the best bait and methods?
Craig, the problem is, mate, it's like we just spoke about Packington. You've got different...
A lot of men, aren't you?
You've got the wind that will affect it. I fished Moorlands twice last year in Fisher Mainers. And I had two real good days. I drew on bank pool one day. I won my section. I didn't frame. And I caught on hard pellets short at the start. I caught bugger all long. Long was crap. But I probably should have fished meat. Should have fed meat with a catapult. That's what I thought when I come away from the venue, even though no one really caught on the long pole. Definitely bombing pellet on bank pool. And on all the pools, really, apart from silver. There's no point setting a feeder up on silver because it's too small.
You're chucking the person's keeping it opposite you, wouldn't you?
You will be, yeah. And then short, like hard pellets short, I changed that to meat and corn. And I caught some fish late on corn. There's a lot of skimmers in bank pool. There's a lot of skimmers in bank. There's a lot of skimmers in meadow. I'm not sure about island. Island's a bit funny. I think you want to draw up into the corners on island where you've got shallow water. I think that'd be quite tough on there. But it'd be hard pellet, 4 mils and 6 mils. And then down the edge, oh dear, you've got to take a selection of maggots and casters. Because if you draw on Silver Lake, you might have to fish either.
Mm.
That would depend on what you think on the day. I can't see on bank pool, I think it was a waste of time, maggots and casters. Well, maggots down the edge was good, dead maggots for the carp, big ones. And I think bank pool would take some beating because there's only 20 pegs on bank now, not 26.
Hmm.
So I think that would take some beating. But I would...
That
I would
Silver Lake throws up some big weights out, doesn't it?
Silverfish Lake would be good. I come third in the match on there on my second visit. Actually, I people were saying, I actually won it, but there was a big weight on Bank. He actually caught Danny Edge on Maggots in the last 2 hours. He caught nothing and he sacked up Danny Edge. And then there was a weight on Moore's Pool, but I don't know. I think he might have caught on Higher Pellets and Danny Edge. But they're old fish in there. They're wise. And you'll find that most of the weights on the older lakes will be shallow, short, and down the edge, and maybe some fish on a bomb because they're old lakes and they're old fish. And Grant, you know, Grant is doing a great job there, and he will turn that place around because he'll put fresh fish in. Silver Lake, really out and out F1 lake. Hard Pellets, maybe some maggot and caster fish in shallow if you draw the right area. If you draw in the low numbers, well, I think
Aidan Mansfield won for
Aidan Mansfield, but he had a spare peg, which we all know the wind was blowing down. It makes a huge difference. And he caught on maggot shallow and short. Meadow, I think, will be a difficult one. That will be hard pellets, corn and meat, I would say, and a bomb. Difficult, mate. So difficult, Craig, to tell you because there's so many bloody lakes.
Yeah. It's a problem with these qualifiers, isn't it? People, you know, I understand why people ask for advice, but
it's a typical lake. So. The old lakes, the lakes with the big carp in, are normal. If you're going to catch them, it'd be a bomb, a waggler, short and down the edge.
Yeah.
You might catch an odd and long, but you're not going to catch enough. It's difficult.
Yeah. And obviously, a lot of time, and then fish eggs, margins is even. Yeah, well, the problem is that Fisher, like, margin isn't even an option on a lot of matches because there's so many people, isn't there?
But you can do. I caught on Bank, but I caught on a top kit.
You was on a good peg, though, weren't you?
No, I wasn't. On 21.
He was in amongst all the fish.
It's a good area. It's in the middle of the lake. It's in the middle of the lake.
That's where you want to be, isn't it?
Where you want to be, really. Or in a corner with the wind hacking in.
Drew two bungholes in two qualifiers. Tracy says you did.
I didn't. I drew all right.
Tracy says, loves the Q&A. Could you recommend ground bait for a natural venue in June? Mostly carp, average 6 to 8 pounds, silvers, big perch, depths 5 to 7 foot.
It sounds like you're putting that ground bait out in open water. The only thing with open water for carp fishing, you probably want a few more particles in it, personally. So I would probably fish with chunky fish and match method mix. And that's what I use on the method. When it's like proper fishing, I've got some chunky fish there. Though. It's not a ground bait I use a lot in the winter, but I use it a lot in the summer. You can even put it down. It's a sort of ground bait, and it's got actually fish particles in it. It's an underestimated ground bait, that.
It really is, yeah.
A lot of people probably don't even know about it, but it's a lovely. It's got all different coloured flecks in it. And it has a real stinky, fishy smell. And I like to mix that in your situation. I'd probably mix that 50-50 with match method mix or pro fatchers. Because, you know, I mean, that's what I would do. But that is a real good ground bait for doing something like you're doing. And even if you want to wrap it around a method. I know people that just fish that for a cage feeder for bream as well. And they catch a lot of bream.
Yeah.
But for me, that is like, if I was doing what you were doing, that would be the ground bait. I would be mixing it with my base mix, which is match method mix.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good ground bait, that.
Yeah, it's a bit like unsung hero, that ground bait, isn't it?
It is. That's exactly what it is. It's an unsung hero. Yeah, that's a good word for that ground bait. It is. But you've got the Noffy. You've got this Benoffy, which has come out. I mean, that is heavy. They're both heavy.
Quite a bit of biscuit in it, that one.
Yeah, that's heavy, but it's a different colour. That's like a light colour, where that's probably why I like chunky fish, because it's still quite a dark colour. If you go into a natural venue, if it's really dirty, it might be using the Benoffy with your match method. If it's not such a dirty coloured water, get on the chunky fish.
Martin says you made him laugh last week, because obviously there's that delay, isn't there, when we click go live, and you says, come on, let's get it going, the quicker the better.
Yeah, but Martin, you've got to realize, it's when we do this,
it's still dinner, went on for 2 hours.
It's dinner time. Do you know what I mean? You've got to get your priorities right. I've got a lot of crap going on in my life at the moment, motorbikes mostly.
Well, there's a reason why nobody else is doing these 2 and 3 hour things.
Anybody's interested in buying my enduro bike, private message me, because I want to get rid of it ASAP, because I can't move in my garage.
This is a good question, and one that we get an awful lot. Brian wants to know, What is the difference, and when would you use a pellet feeder instead of a method feeder?
Well, Brian, that is a tricky question. And I used to get this in my mind. I used to get the same in the same thing. It's an hard one to, you can't really explain it. All I know is a pellet feeder on its day is deadly. The way it releases its bait, because that's what it is. It's completely different to a method feeder. A method feeder releases its bait everywhere in a pile all the way around the feeder, where a pellet feeder releases the bait out of the front only. If a fish wants to eat out of that feeder, right, it's basically eating where your hook bait is, because your hook bait's been spilled out of the end. You know, you can just imagine that's like the old pellet feeder style. So everything has to come out here. If that was a method feeder, you've got everything like a pile around it. And on its day, and I didn't realise how deadly they can be, I went down White Acres with Adam Wakeley and Jason the Bosque. And then even Jason the Bosque was like, I think it was that way or the other way around. And Jason said, do you use them pellet feeders then, Des? And I said, well, yeah. And I was chucking out. I was getting one every single chuck. There was no dinking. There was none of this on the tip. It was like that. It goes like that. Whoom, straight round. F1s and carp.
Mm.
And I went to a method. I caught on it, but it was never as good as a pellet feeder.
Yeah.
And I do use both. I love, my favorite feeder of all time is the ICS method feeder. You know, it's just, I've caught so many fish on it. I could do so much with it. But there is days when the pellet feeder is unbeatable. And I know there's people that go, when we were fishing shearwater the other year, when we were allowed to fish it in the winter, there's people just fishing a pellet feeder.
Mm. Yeah.
And they're catching.
Brilliant.
They compact the bait in very, very well. You can get that bait down to the bottom in 20 foot of water and it comes out when it goes on the bottom.
Yeah, brilliant.
For me,
really are good.
They are really, really good. You need to go out and experiment with them. The disadvantage of a pellet feeder is really you can't use ground bait in them because it won't come out. The nice thing about a pellet feeder is you can also put bigger pellets in it. You can put chalk worm in it. You can put live maggots in it and cap it off with pellets on the front.
Mm-hmm.
People don't do that so much because it's not probably the in thing,
but you can
put 4 mil pellets in it, 6 mil pellets in it, you know, tap it off at the end with a few soap micros. There's lots of advantages to a pellet feeder that people probably don't try. I remember going to Lindo in the Winter League final or some match. It was Joe on it.
Drennan knockout
or something. And it's, no, the team thing it was. And on Bonsai, the fish on there were totally switched on to a pellet. Unless you were on a lot of fish, you struggled to catch on a feeder because they were proper clued up on it.
Mm.
And the way to fish it was chop worm through a when you weren't on a lot of fish, when you had to catch barbel, hide, bream, tench, the odd carp, bloody chop worm through a pellet.
Brilliant, that was the old chop worm feeder. That's
brilliant. Yeah, tap it off with a few micros, head of a worm on a size 16, 4-inch hook length. Bloody brilliant. There's lots of options you do with a pellet feeder, a lot.
Yeah, White Acres again, like Trelawney and Twin Oaks have won two matches on them lakes on pellet feeder, and you change the method and it's like not quite right.
Yeah, they get away with it on a pellet feeder. They can't get away with it so often. A classic example for me, and I've probably spoke about this before, I went to Italy with Angelo. We were on these lakes. I can't remember the lakes. They were Solomon fish. It was in the winter. It was really cold. The first year I went there, it was an out-and-out method job. We weren't allowed to use ground bait. It was all pellets. So whatever you fished, it had to be pellets. It was a pellet match. And I did try a pellet feeder, and it was just like, no. I don't know why. I can't explain it. The following year, I went there. I was with Mick Slater, one of the agents for Preston. And we drove up. We managed to get there. I said, any good, Angelo? He said, yeah, the fishing's really good, Des. And he was fishing a method feeder. And I watched him, and he was getting odd little knock and all that. I said, oh, right, they're a bit different to last year. He said, yeah, they're more crafty. I said, you got any pellet feeders, Anjo? He said, like, well, yeah. I said, well, give us one here. So we put an ICS pellet feeder on, chucked out, and caught one every single chuck within half the time.
Hmm.
And Anjo's like, I can't believe that. And that whole week, everyone was fishing a pellet feeder.
Yeah.
It,
They were the big ones, weren't they? Is that when you went? And
they were like them. Yeah, we weren't messing about. We put some bait in.
Yeah.
But the difference was they weren't getting away with it. With a you catch them on a method, but you weren't catching enough. You weren't catching them as quick.
Yeah.
So it does work. But that was a long-winding.
But do you know what is quite funny? I when I first started at Preston, I remember saying to, it was Mick Biles and Robbie actually at one of the clubs. I was like, oh, do people use pellet feeders still? Because I like them and certain anglers like them, but not everyone likes them. And Mick was saying, like, most of the club anglers in that area certainly use them, pellet scoops on smaller venues, Lindome and such. And it's dead right, isn't it? I think club anglers absolutely love them, and rightly so.
A pellet feeder takes the whole, it makes it so simple because it's just a scoop. And you scoop it. You don't have to think about your ground bait. You don't have to. The only thing you've got to get right with a pellet feeder is make sure your pellets are quite dry. Yeah. If you have them real wet and sticky, they won't come out.
Yeah.
So make sure your pellets are dried, quite crumbly. I call it crumbly pellets.
Yeah.
So you can force them in, and as you thumb them in, you'll actually see them go like that. They're like, whoop, ready to come out.
Yeah.
If you have them where they go in like a method, you'll wind back in half your time your bait's still inside.
Right, Ian Connie, this says, help please, I can't seem to catch short, i.e. top kit plus two on Campbell Lake at Viaduct. When should I go on it and how should I feed it?
It's a hard question because I don't, you know, because I think you just, there's one thing you've got to try, and Campbell can be a bit of a mare with different baits, but don't throw too much bait in. They're big fish, they're wise. You know, you're not fishing for that. You don't need to catch lots of fish on there. You'll catch 200 pound there with like 15 fish. You know what I mean? 20 fish. It's an hard one. All I would say is just take it easy. Whether you're fishing with pellets or meat, normally it's pellets and meat short on there. I can't say why you're not catching, because that's literally, I would love to be able to say why I didn't catch today. And I can't sometimes. I just think, you know, and sometimes don't, if it's basically warm as well, sometimes you don't have to feed it until you're fishing it. You know, if you're fishing elsewhere and you think, oh, I want to go on my short line, 5 minutes or 10 minutes before you actually want to go on it, then just plonk a couple of pellets in. Sometimes if you're feeding it all the time, then fish don't come, they come in, they've gone because they're big and wise.
Often a timing thing, isn't it?
It's more of a timing thing. So obviously you can start on there. If it's the height of summer, sometimes you can go straight in short and have a couple straight away. You know, listen, there's loads of times that I've been to those venues and I haven't caught short. And it pisses me off because I know that, you know, have I fed it too much? Have I not fed enough? Have I got my timing wrong? It's one of them. Don't let it eat you away. It eats me away, and you just got to forget it, because you can go the following week and you catch a load short. But the things that I've said to you just a minute ago is don't feed too much, and sometimes try not to feed it unless you're fishing it, because they're wise. They come in, they have a bit, and they scoot off and don't come back. And really, you can feed so little some days, it's ridiculous. You can feed like two pellets, three pellets, and sit there and wait for a bite. It's not all about banging them in. But it's a very tricky question to ask, but to answer. But just try and, if you can, try and take that away with you.
Nick Parry, this is quite an interesting.
Also, one thing is try and fish out a section further.
Yeah.
Put top kit plus three on instead of a top kit plus two.
Nick Parry says, how close can you have two different pole lines without one affecting the other? Good question, that.
Yeah, it depends on the fishing, I think. If you're F1 fishing, you can have it like a 2-3 foot apart and start another line. Personally, for me, when I'm carp fishing or surface fishing, I would say the minimum I go is probably 2 meters. It just don't feel right if I'm not. It's especially if I'm priming a line up, I want them further apart. If I'm like F1 fishing and I'm not feeding a different line, then I think you can have them a lot closer. I think if you're priming the line up on that, say you're fishing like 2 13-meter lines and I'm priming one up with a catapult, and I'm fishing another line, I would want them at least two to three meters apart. If it's F1 fishing in, and you're not fit, you're not priming the line up, then I think you can have a, you can just start another line a meter away to a meter and a half away and start again. But I would say normal for me on a typical silverfish stroke carp water, priming the line, I want it at least a meter and a half away to 2 meters, especially when catapulting, because obviously there's a bit of overspill going here, there, and everywhere.
Awesome. South says, I'm going to be fishing a gravel pit this weekend for roach, and there's odd carp in there. It's 15 foot deep. I don't want to be conventional and go the feeder route. I'd like to pole fish it. Any tips?
Well, gravel pit, obviously, if it's a gravel pit, it's very clear. So I could, I would go very careful that you I don't know, perhaps it is a coloured gravel pit. I'm not too sure, but if it's very clear, you might not even catch on the pole unless it's proper solid with roach. There's lots of gravel pits where I live, you know, and you wouldn't catch on the pole. It's just too clear. Or you might catch right at the end.
If a not, waggler.
Oh, 15-foot waggler fishing. Get a few ponds. Yeah, you might catch shallow for a roach. I would just take it easy on the pole. I would probably put a couple of balls of ground bait in. Have the option of going past. So don't over, you know, put your ground bait in short so at least you can go past it. And loose feed. If I don't know what baits you're going to be using, but if you're catching roach, you're probably going to be using maggots or casters as well at the fall. So just put some casters, a few dead maggots in your ground bait. Loose feed will, I would say, will be mega important for roach, especially in that depth of water. And you might catch off the bottom. You might catch a couple of feet off the bottom in that depth of water, especially at the start of the session before they go down. And set up a gram rig all strung out. I know it's not sort of thing. I mean, somewhere sometimes I go to Porth Reservoir and I'm fishing out long, and I know there's roach in me peg, and always a lot of time, if, unless I know it's fishing really well for skimmers. You have like a gram rig and it's all strung out with, like, you start off with a couple of number nines and they're all strung out with number eight shot. And it's like, it's not sort of what we do all the time, but sometimes that can catch you a lot of roach on big waters like that. But like Joe said, you might even catch shallow, like 3-4 foot deep, because they won't go down.
Depends on the conditions, doesn't it? This time of year, when that sun comes.
Clarity of water, which will do it. You know, if it's really clear, you might not catch. If it's dirty, just put a bit of ground bait in, but loose feed, whether you're fishing with maggots or casters, definitely 100% loose feed, like 20, 30 bits of bait every few minutes.
Yeah, nice. Richard Webb says, I'm looking to update an older pole, and the model I use still uses a traditional number one section. What diameter, ideally, should match and power kit tips be these days for internal bushes?
Well, that's all done for you.
Yeah, you know, good poles.
When you buy the poles nowadays, like our response poles,
even the prototypes,
it's all done for you. You don't have to worry about it. It's all done. Like all the power tops, I don't know what the diameters are. We don't even think about that anymore. I used to, but it's all done for you. It's done to take the elastics that you need for those top kits. The only, obviously, the difference is in our top kits is the actual, what would you call it?
Taper.
Yeah, the taper is different. So the taper on a match kit is a lot faster than it is on a power kit. But the bushes in the end are all made to do what you want with that top kit. So I wouldn't even worry about that. Most poles now, whatever you decide to buy, it's all done for you. You know, your power top would take any elastic from a 5 to a 17. And your match tops, depending on what pole you go for, our match tops take from like a number 2 elastic to a number 8 elastic, which is obviously what you'd be using in match tops. You got your F1 tops take from a number 2 elastic to a number sort of 13 elastic. So it's all done for you. I don't even know what I'm saying. It's all changed now. It's all done for you, like a lot of things, isn't it? It's all done for you. All you do is smack the elastic you want in the top kits.
Go fishing.
And go fishing. So it's all done for you now.
Yeah, that's how it should be. You want a decent sized bush though, if it, you know, if you are still chopping them back, don't you? You want, it's better to go a little bit bigger and have a nice stiff top kit, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't know. It's like, well, we do bushes, don't we? But I think
Yeah,
we do
big range sizes as well.
I think Matt matched.
It's about 4 mil, isn't it, for a power kit? I think
3.2 bigger for a power top, something like that.
Nice big bush.
Crap. That's a good question, but I am crap at answering that.
Here's a good one for you. This is a good one. Why, oh, why do Preston keep bringing out new rods?
Why?
We don't. Is the honest answer.
We don't. We bring
out... It's like a four-year cycle.
A long time. For us as a company, some companies bring out rods every single year.
It's a four-year cycle for Preston.
I think we're pretty damn good, really. Mm. We don't, you know, we work on projects all the time. Rods, poles, all sorts of stuff going on, which, like I say, on all these Q&As, it might not never happen. You know, I'm using odd bits and pieces at the moment, and it might not even never be seen on the bank, as for you guys.
Yeah.
But no, I think we do really well, as in, I think where people get confused is, because we bring a new range out,
it tends to be staggered, doesn't it? So you have ignition one year, then you'll have a monster a couple of years after. So you go a couple of years after that.
It's not, exactly. It's not as short as what you think.
No, it isn't. Like Superior has been out good while now.
Yeah, everything. It's like the poles now. The excess poles have been out for a good 3 years.
Mm.
You know, so I think we do quite well not to confuse you that much.
Yeah,
but things move on. Things move on. Better value for money, I think. Well, definitely. You get value for money for what you get. Mm-hmm. If you look back 20 or 15 years ago, what you used to get for a couple of grand for a pole and what you get now, it is massive. The difference is massive.
Yeah.
So, but that's, you know, that's...
Yeah. It's a bit of a perception thing, that is. But we do, it tends to be in like a four-year cycle, rods. So
yeah,
it's not as often as it may seem. Glenn says he saw a video of you doing how you attach your kit safe to a side tray, but can't find it again. Can you show us again? Well, it's on Instagram and Facebook.
On my Facebook page.
On Instagram as well, isn't it?
Yeah, Instagram, Facebook. If you go on my Facebook page or Instagram page and look at about two or three things back, I run it through as clear as you could possibly get it.
Yeah, it's easier to show it than explain it in that garage.
That one I done the other day at Morans explains it so easily.
Can't get clearer than that, can it, really?
So it's all that's why I've done it, because I've been asked quite a few times.
Yeah.
You know, how to do it, and it's clear as a day.
Russ says, brilliant tips, great series. The only thing that's really annoying is the little teasers that you keep doing of new products.
Well, that's Joe's job.
That's my job, isn't it?
If it weren't for that, Joe would be out of
a job. I'd be out of a job, wouldn't I? I'm just looking if there's anything else I can tease while I'm at it.
I ain't got nothing, actually.
I've got my stops. Yeah, look, little stops. They're coming soon.
Stop. Brilliant. The stops are awesome.
There's a little feeder in my hand here that nobody can see.
So that would get him the sack.
Nah, probably not. It's been an odd little sighting now on Facebook.
That's what it's all about, isn't it? It is, you know, that's...
Marketing, isn't it, at the end of the day?
Yeah, I'm sorry about that, but that's
simply form, isn't it?
And I get it. I get the same. I see stuff and I can't get it. So I'm in the same boat sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, right. A lot of people asking about your motocross lark. No one wants to buy it, though.
Come on, man.
What sort of distance do you think you could get with an 11-foot ignition?
Comfortably, I would say 40 meters, I reckon. Quite nicely at 35 to 40 meters. If you start trying to go to 50, I think you're going to struggle. I think 35 to 40, you'll be all right, personally. I think if you want to go further than that, you'll need to go to some Monster X or a Supera.
I'm sorry, my questions have just got jumbled up again.
Right, like a 10 foot Superior would probably cast longer than 11 foot ignition for most people.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference between the carbons that you're buying.
Yeah, here's one that I get asked quite a bit actually. Do you ever sell your tackle second hand? Can't, can we?
No.
A lot of it goes back, doesn't it?
A lot of my gear is wrecked anyway. I let my brother have a bit, my nephew have a bit.
Give it away to kids a lot of the time, I do.
Kids, I give it away to odd, you know, bits and pieces. I've got loads of stuff here, obviously, that I've just kept because I wouldn't want to get rid of it anyway. It's just one of them. You think, oh, what? And it's pointless, really, because I would never use it. But I just think, oh, I would never get rid of that. I've got loads of float rods here that I probably will never probably use again.
I'm a rod hoarder, I am.
I am terrible. I don't want to get rid of them because I've used them and I like them. And I'm like, oh, but they're not as good as like the ones we do now. I won't never want to get rid of them. It's like my bike's really, but I don't really want to get rid of my bike, but I've got, it's got to go.
You need to get rid of one of them. Bloody hell.
Rid of one of them, yeah.
Would you recommend the Superior 11.6 feeder fishing for bream on natural waters?
Yeah, it's fine.
That's
it's
another fine. Unsung hero of a rod. That
it is. Yeah, it is. A lot of people, you know, when I was fishing the River Avon back a bit, that is a fantastic bream rod for river fishing because it is quite pokey.
Yeah, it's got a bit of power, hasn't it?
Brilliant for like bream fishing and that. You know, I like the 12.6, 50 gram. I think it's a lovely rod. But it is, like Joe said, it is one of them unsung heroes again. It is one of them rods that is sort of there, but it's no problem at all. Fish with carp and bream with that rod. It just depends on the distance that you really want to push yourself. But that rod's got some beef, I'll tell you.
Yeah. Lee really used it last week. I went out filming with Lee and he was chucking right across Allcroft up against the Firebank platforms. And it was just so easy with that rod. And he was like, why don't I use this rod more often?
It is one of them.
Yeah.
No problem at all in using that.
John Wood would like to know what pole from the response range would you use if you're fishing for F1s one day and great big carp the next?
I'd probably go for an XS carp because it's going to cover you. The only problem is the only thing with the XS carp is, it's not a problem, is the actual spares packages is all power tops.
Yeah,
you get eight power tops. I think it's 8 or 9 power tops. But obviously, if you were fishing for F1s, you might want to invest into some short stops or F1 top twos. But for 40, like around about 50 quid, I think the short stops are about 45 quid. And an F1 top two is about 50, 60 quid. I think they're 60 quid RRP, which will get them a bit less than that. So if you're catching those big lumps, I would go for an XS carp, but invest in a few F1 top twos and a few short stops, and then you've got the best of both worlds then. That's what I would do personally. I think it's a great pole because it just gives you that added sort of
insurance, isn't it?
Yeah, it's insurance. It's added thing in your head that you're going somewhere, you can catch some great big units and you're okay with it.
Just good all around that, isn't it?
And they're a great price as well, which is, and the spares. The thing is, like I say to people, look, think about, like, when you buy a pole, also think about if you make a mistake with a pole, you know, we all do, you know, the rollers might go over in the wind, you might get off your box to have a pee or something, and you break a section. The sections for them poles are not that expensive. They're, and that's something you've got to think about. If you go and break in like a number 10 meter piece or 11 meter piece, on some poles, it is extortionate. And I know on the response poles, they are bloody reasonable for what you're buying. So that's what I always say, you know, think about that as well.
Yeah. Paul Wilkinson says, just wanted to thank you both. I'm currently shielding and I've been for a while. You two sharing your time and knowledge is brilliant. Love to watch them. Thank you very much. No problem at all. Afternoon, chaps. This is Darren Barnes. Superb what you're doing each week. I've just got some short kits for shallow fishing. Are they suitable for mugging large carp or should I stick to using them for F1s?
It depends on what venue you go. If you go to somewhere, some of the venues I go, like if you went to Gold Valley, Viaduct.
You ain't got a chance, have you?
You're wasting.
Not enough elastic, is it?
Not enough elastic. If you go to like venues I go, like Acorn, the carp are really like nice there. They're like, oh, I don't mind being caught. You'll probably get away with it. But personally, if I was mugging for big carp, it would just be a normal top kit, 2.4, whatever pole you've got. and have a nice elastic in it, like going back to that 13 jaw slip. There's only one thing, it's funny really, because I've done this on venues mugging. If you've, where is it? I think it might be Viaduct. I've done a bit of mugging before on the big units on Campbell and Kerry and that. And if you use a nice elastic, some people use nice elastics and they get away with it because they've got, sometimes you've got to fish like lighter bottoms and they go off and you get them back. Sometimes they go off and you can't stop them. Now, if you use a real heavy elastic, you hook them and they're like nodding dogs.
Mm. Turns like, sometimes, isn't it?
Ooh, all the way in and you can get them in.
Mm.
It's one of them. It's something you've got to try. You can fish like a 17 or a nice 13, and it depends on the day whether they're I call them nodding dogs.
Mm.
They're like that. You hook
Glebe's
like,
a classic that Des. You know, you probably use a 11 hollow, for example, shallow. You hook them, they go along the far bank and break you. But you fish 13 hollow shallow and they don't make it and they come back.
Yeah.
It's funny. Isn't it?
It's funny, yeah. It's down the edge sometimes. I've been to venues you can fish like 17 elastics and you hook them, they're like, ah, whoa, they're all way in. Horrible, you know, it ain't great. And then you look at, you think, oh, that's a bit heavy. Put a nice light elastic on, they're like, ah, wow, and they're gone and they snap you up because they can't stop them. But yeah, that's, you know, normally if you fish a nice elastic, you're normally all right.
Yeah.
I don't know where the question was. I don't know where we went with that question.
Shark hits. I do think they're better for F1s personally.
Get it. Don't do it. Big carp, just fish with a normal.
If someone else asked, is there any, you know, would you use them up against islands and stuff? And
definitely.
If you're a partridge guy and a tunnel barn guy, then they're absolutely brilliant for that, aren't they?
Yeah, I fished yesterday, I was catching carp with 10 pound. I could have used a shortstop with several different grades of elastic, depending on what I was catching, obviously in between the carp, right? With a shortstop, no problem whatsoever. I could go to a different venue and they'd be climbing up the bank. They'd be belting down the bank and you'd be thinking, Jesus Christ. You know what I mean? And it just depends on the actual carp and the fishery.
I always think if 90% of the fish you're catching are the same or very similar size, then they're brilliant. But if you go to one of them venues, like I went to one the other day, when 1 minute you're catching an F1, then you're catching an 8-pounder. Sometimes you just don't have enough elastic, do you?
No. That little bit of like, what is it? 1.8. It's not very much, really.
Yeah, but it's quite a lot, isn't it? When it stretches 7-1 or 8-1.
Right. So, yeah, stick with power tops for the units.
Yeah, I agree.
Unless they're really nice.
Wallowers.
And they're nodders.
Right, Paul Wilkinson, who's just been saying very nice things about us. Two questions.
Not all.
He says, do you have any coaching days spare for later in the year?
I'm not doing any coaching at the moment. I won't be until this is completely cleared up. So I don't personally, in my opinion, I don't think it's right. Mm-hmm. I don't want to create any aggro for anybody. And I certainly don't want to get people onto me saying, no, you shouldn't be doing this. You shouldn't. I know there are people and that's up to them. But I won't be doing it for a while. The only project, which I've spoke to about this before is I haven't spoken to them about it for a while because obviously it's just not worth it. But I hopefully going to start doing, and I know you guys might not want to do it, but I'm going to try and do some group days. And for me, group days, I think I would prefer to do a group day. I think I personally would get more out of it, and I'm covering a lot more people at the same time. So that's something that I might be doing depending on what goes on with the crap in the world at the moment. But at the moment, no. But you will know about it. Whichever way I go, you will know about it if I do start doing stuff again.
Lovely. And the second question that he wanted to ask, he's never match fished before, and he's looking to start in a few weeks when he's allowed out again. What would be your number one piece of advice for anyone starting match fishing?
Well, look at all the, don't get too confused. It's like yesterday. If I was going to a match where I went yesterday for a few hours, on your bait tray, I would have had a few expanders, some hard pellets, a bit of corn, and some dead maggots. And don't just go there. Try and suss out, you know, try and work out what they're catching on. But don't get taken every bait that you own, because you will go at your own backside if you're not careful. And that's probably the biggest thing in match fishing. And it's like something we spoke about earlier. I can take and I can have on my bait tray casters, maggots, corn, pellets, expanders, ground bait, and I can use the baits that I think I want to catch on, which I want to catch on, but a lot of the other baits are there just to think, this ain't happening today. I need to change. And that does happen a lot, but try and go there with a bit of a clean head and don't worry about other people. I get a lot of this asked on Messenger and stuff. Des, on, I want to go to my first match. What do you think? It's not easy because it is a match and you're under pressure because you want to do well. Every one of us wants to walk off that bank and think that bloke over there is looking at me thinking, bloody hell, mate, you've done brilliant. That don't always happen. But don't get too upset about it. You know what I mean? Try and learn whilst you're fishing. Try and look round. And you'll always find there's venues you go, people that will talk to you and tell you where they've caught, what they fed. But I think personally, just try and keep your baits nice and simple. Try and obviously, it depends on what you're fishing for, obviously. And just try and enjoy the situation, but don't give up. Don't just walk off there thinking, oh, I'm crap at this. I'm giving up. You can't do that. And I think this generation, the generation now, a lot of people do that, the younger generation. They get involved in it, think they're just going to get it like that. And fishing ain't like that. Fishing, I've done it since I was a kid, and I never went match fishing since I was like mid-20s because I didn't think I was any good at it. And I didn't have the, I just felt a bit out of place. But that's what you got to do. You've got to put your time in. You're not just going to, just because you watch videos and we try and help you as much as we can, it don't mean to say you're going to go out. But a lot of people, it has helped because I get a lot of feedback saying your bloody videos have helped me out so much over the, like, God knows how many years. And that's what it's all about at the end of the day. But don't give up. Don't just walk off there and think, stand the back door and we'll spin out the car park. No, I'm never coming back. Go there. And make sure you pleasure fish as well. Don't just keep fishing matches. Go out and practice what you need to practice to try and compete.
Yeah. Join a club as well. I think that's a really good bit of advice.
Join a club. Yeah. Join a club if you can. And they always go round. Gary, a guy I know, a driver, they got a lovely little club. Do you know what I mean? They go to different venues, they have a laugh. That's the nice thing about a club thing. They all know each other. You get to know people and you have a good laugh. You all travel together. Obviously, all this crap at the moment's upset the old breakfast situation and that, hasn't it?
And a lot of them, like when the boozers are open, they go and have a pint and that.
Good crack. Yeah, get done for drink driving on the way home and all that sort of stuff.
Oh, dear. Moving on. Jeff says, do you prefer the carp shallow floats for edge fishing or do you fish the edge float ever?
Well, I think everybody who knows me said, I like fishing floats that are a nice float. I mean, the carp edge, I could probably fish the carp edge what I was doing yesterday. It's a thicker bristle. It's a slightly different shape body. I just prefer the carp shallow because it's got a slightly finer bristle. And I love that. I love that shape like that. I do. I think it's a great shape float. You can do so much with that. I think, to be honest, it depends on what you want to use. If you want to use a carp edge down the edge, if it's like big bait, summertime, you want a proper big bristle stuck out, brilliant. With that float there, the one I use, I can have that dotted down. I can have a bit of bristle showing. It's just one of them floats. I've got some carp edges made up, but when I go into a fishery like I did yesterday, I was catching Carassio F1s, and that finer bristle just suited for what I was doing. If it's out and out full blown, big carp, big baits, then that edge for me would be the one out the box.
Yeah, I think like a place like Larford and stuff like that, when you're fishing for real things, that floats great perfect,
big,
isn't it?
Yeah, thick lines, big hooks, catching great big units down the edge, up against islands, you'd have the edge float out every time. Because it takes the weight. The thing is with that edge float as well, it takes real heavy line nicely. If you use the wrong float with real heavy line, it starts sitting on angles like that, where that edge float is
It bosses the rig.
Bosses the line, yeah. It tells the line, no, you're not going to make me sit on an angle. I'm going to sit up straight. And that's what it's about, really.
I'm gonna do another 10 minutes, Des, because I don't want to go on for too long because I have got a lot of work to do again. It's that time of year, mate. It's just
you don't have to tell me, listen, you don't have to make excuses to me.
Yeah. I'm going to have my lunch.
So
my sausage and egg sandwich was better than that banana you had at Morland's on Tuesday.
Huh. Who said that?
Don't
I? I know who that was. That was the guy opposite me, I reckon.
Sorry.
I might have been John, was it? I cricked my neck actually sitting.
Yeah, no, is it John? No, Steve Tinsley's called.
Right. I actually met a guy there that I've not seen for absolute years. Paul Carhill, his name was. We used to call him Greasy. Because when he used to go to Moreland years ago, he used to come out, he's like he just come out of a case catalogue. All his hair was all greased back. It was perfect. Yeah, it was like and I've seen it. I haven't seen him for 20 years, I reckon. I've seen him when I was down there filming. Yeah. Really nice to see him. Anyway, if you're listening, Paul, good to see you.
Luke Perkins says, I seen you at you went to Shears with the other day. Did you catch in the edge? Yes, I did. I had him tailing up and everything. It was brilliant.
No more draw, Luke.
Pellets and corn was the way the other day. They loved it. Just obviously, I was pleasuring, so they were in there. Do Preston sell a pre-tied rig for using close to an island and also down the edge? We will be doing.
Not yet, but they're on their way.
Hmm.
They're on their way, so they will be done.
This is a funny question. We're getting this quite a lot recently, the old discontinued nonsense. Bit of misinformation going on out there at the minute. Would you recommend the Inception seat box, or are they discontinued to buy? No, they're not.
No.
Recently we've got been the new, improved.
We've got the new Inception station, which is an awesome little box, but they're not discontinued at all.
Yeah. Robert Driscoll says, if and when we come out of lockdown, will these discussions continue? Yes, they will, but probably a bit more ad hoc.
Only if it's pouring down with rain.
Yeah, because Des will be out fishing all the time.
I'll be out fishing. If I come off a motocross bike, I might be able to do it from Southmead Hospital with my legs up in the air and all that sort of
thing. Don't be doing that.
No,
in all seriousness, we will do it. But obviously, as soon as we get out,
yeah,
there's a lot of filming for us to be doing. So it will
happen, won't it? It just won't be.
Probably won't be weekly.
Won't be set in stone like it is now, sort of thing.
Yeah. Obviously, we've enjoyed doing it. It's very, very good for you guys to talk to us. But, you know, obviously, we've got jobs to do as well.
I've said it umpteen times now. I mean, I said to Joe, when Joe mentioned it to me, I'm like, oh, I don't know about that. I think that'd be a bit boring for people. But all the stuff we've had back from the bank, absolutely love it. So it's been a pleasure, really.
Mm, it's been one of the most important things we've done, I think.
Definitely. Especially
for Preston. So, sorry, I'm just trying to pick a real good one.
All right. What are you trying to say? There's loads of crap ones.
No, there's a lot of like hi lads and all that sort of stuff. I can't see you, so I don't worry about it. Right, I fish a lot of evening matches in the summer. Do you change your approach at all when fishing evening matches?
Yeah, big style. When I used to fish Morelands back in the day, we used to actually fish the day match and we used to stay on in the evening match and get back home about 11:30 at night on Saturday and Sunday. Yeah, obviously short and down the edge. And you used to even catch short shallow. You know, really fishing long. It was, you had 3 hours. Three and a half hours on the evening, you had to catch short, really speaking. And you might even just fish in the edge immediately.
You know what's funny? Because I've done quite a lot of evening matches over the years. Yeah. And you just assume, don't you? You'll plonk your box down and bag up in the edge because it's 6 o'clock. And there's always that lull, like an hour and a half waiting for them to come in. It's weird.
The trouble is, you've got to catch down there to win.
Yeah.
So, yeah, really, you've got to, really evening matches, it's definitely fishing short, down the edges. And you can catch so short as well off the end of your keep net. You can literally fish a top kit.
Hmm.
A top kit plus one instead of a top kit plus two. Obviously, baits will depend on the venue you fish, but you might have to beef everything up, thicker elastics because you're fishing down the edges in short. Yeah, really, it is slightly different. You just got to you just got to fish short, really. When I used to fish moorings, it was all... You might have fished long for half an hour to catch one or two, but then you were looking around the lake. As soon as someone caught short, that was it. You were straight in short, and then it was down the edge. And it all depended how quick you could catch down the edge. That was the key to it, really.
Yeah.
You catch short and short, and all of a sudden you'd be like down the edge. You'd be like watching someone's caught one down the edge, or someone started banging on the edge. You had to follow suit because you had to follow suit to win.
I've really enjoyed evening matches. I used to do quite a lot at Shears Bit one time.
Yeah.
Good fun.
Oh, me and Steve May used to get home. We was younger back then. We were wrecked. We used to fish four matches, like the day matches and the evening matches. You get home. It like 12 o'clock on Sunday night, you'd be back at work at 6 o'clock, you'd be going like a zombie. So, yeah, they were good, good matches back then.
Good matches. Might try and get on a few of them myself this year, actually.
Yeah, we ain't got nothing around here really for evenings,
don't you?
Not really, no. There's a few, but
Dave Cunn says, I'm a bit lost. When would you use shots and when would you use styles?
Well, styles for me, if you're talking about commercial fishing, forget it, because I use stots, which is the same as styles, really, but obviously a lot better, bigger. They take the line a lot better. If you're talking about sort of natural venues, styles for me are hairy fairy rigs. So if you looked, I haven't got any at hand, but I've got rigs for like squat fishing, which have got tiny little styles, like 13 size 12 styles, which are tiny, and they'll all be strung out. It's for sort of catching on the drop. And that's the only thing for me where styles would ever play a part. It is basically hairy fairy squat fishing and hairy fairy bloodworm fishing. When it's pretty crap, the fish want everything on the drop, all nice and slow, like the drains, things like that. And then shot or just normal out and out day to day fishing. But styles is hairy fairy fishing for me. It doesn't come into play in my fishing whatsoever unless I'm going to a venue which is so difficult and you've got to catch little roach or crafty roach on the drop. I don't even take them to my commercial fishing. The only time I would take them now is if I went on the Kettenhaven Canal, the Gloucester Canal, where it was like trying to get a few snots.
You remember, Des, pulling out of a fish on a style rig, a roach, and it balling up. Oh, my God. We spent hours tying these rigs to the new junction with number 7 styles all the way up.
I don't think I've got them here. They are here somewhere, but they're normally on rigs. The float is called a surge, and they were my style rigs. Even with bread punch and things like that, when it was really tough, you used to fish a little strung out style rig and it would get you some bites. But don't even do it. Don't even, well, it just wouldn't happen no more.
Really, like Ringer and Phil and Steve used to use styles on the cart rigs, didn't they, back in the day?
Yeah, long time ago.
Everyone just put a shot on there, don't they?
Shot and stops. Thanks for coming.
Is mixing match method and factors a good idea?
I use it all the time. I think it's a brilliant mix. I use it a lot on the method. I think it's probably one of my favourite mixes, to be honest. I mix them together. I normally mix like half a bag of Thatcher's to half a bag of match method mix if I'm catching lots of fish. But if you do something like a 50-50 mix, I think it's a fantastic mix of the method. The Thatcher's has got a heavier base to it. And it's quite sticky as well, Thatcher's, if you mix it like on the damp side. I think it's a great mix because it's finer. It's actually finer than match method mix. And I like that. I like them two mixed together. It's beautiful. But nice
combo.
Great, yeah, great mix, that is.
Let's just do a couple more then. This is a funny one. Landlocked sea fishing watches every single week, then without fail. He says, landlocked sea fishing must be like a YouTube channel. He says, can you please adjust the string on your hoodie? He says, for people like him who suffer with OCD, it's very annoying.
Let me tell you something about landlocked sea fishing. Shall I tell you what I normally do with these?
Chop them off and pull them out.
That is what I normally do with them. Because I always find myself, I'm like Rupert the Bear walking about. So is that better for you now? That's what I do to most of my...
Right, this is quite an interesting question. Kevin Hansen says, what are your views on TV doing more for angling? Because it's supposed to be the most popular pastime sport hobby in the country. I think that, what was the show that's been on BBC and it's gone down really well?
Oh, that's with
Bob Mortimer, isn't it?
And yeah, that's brilliant. I love that. It is proper. Yeah, I really like that. I thought it was bloody.
I think shows brilliant. Like that are brilliant for fishing, aren't yeah. they?
You know, it's a pity because you had John Wilson, Matt Hayes, didn't you? You know, them two, the Mortimer and that. I thought that was great. It was so like the fishing was just part of it, wasn't it? Really, it was like a bit of a thing.
I think it paints fishing in a really good light. I do.
It does, yeah. I don't know. Listen, we all know it's like it comes down to money. It comes down to advertising. You know, it's like football, isn't it? If people will spend millions on advertising somewhere in a commercial break in amongst Man United playing Man City. If it come down to me and Joe fishing a match and it was advertising between, you probably wouldn't get anybody. You probably have aspirin advertising on it. So it comes down to that. It is, we all know fishing is massive. And I think the biggest problem with fishing is, unless you make it lightheartedly like them two did, it's quite funny, isn't it? It's to watch someone, it's like Fishermania. To watch 5 hours of fishing is quite difficult, isn't it? It's like, oh, you know, it's not like watching Formula Ones where someone's going to crash and kill themselves. I don't know. All I know is it's a lot better than what it used to be. So hopefully it will move in the right direction and do a few things. It's a pity about Sky with tight lines. You know, that was good.
That was good. I used to enjoy tight lines.
Like that. You know, I mean, I used to watch that and I got involved in it and I thought it was really, really good. Unfortunately, obviously Sky had budgets that they had to meet and fishing, like a lot of sports, it ain't just fishing, a lot of sports were dropped. And it's a shame, really, but that's the way of life with them sort of
things. But that sort of real nice feel-good sort of viewing, easy viewing. Yeah. And it's on prime time as well, wasn't it?
Got to be funny as well. It's got to have this humour to it, I think. It's like Jimmy.
It doesn't want to be forced, though, does it? Like some of the stuff you see on telly, I won't mention who by, it's just a little bit forced. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
A bit fake. And I don't like that. It wants to be nice and natural.
Yeah, you've got to have a laugh. There's some good stuff out there, isn't there?
Absolutely. And,
but that was one of the best ones I've seen with the two comedians because he's. He also tells you about his life story with his health problems and that. And you think, oh, Christ, I didn't know that. There you go. Anyway, a bit like me by losing weight, really.
How's it going?
It's just stopped. I can't do anything else. No, I've got down to like 15.7. I went up to 15.10. That's it. Unless I have a blowout, nothing changes.
I'm almost in my athletic prime again now.
I'm in limbo. But I'm all right. I feel good. I'm ready to go match fishing.
This is a funny question. Paul Fegan says he's fishing Woodland View later this year. Is it okay to use non-fishery pellets to make the blown hard pellets?
I would probably say yes, because it's a hook bait. Because you can take expanders there, and I'm sure 100% that you could take hookable, soft, hard pellets, if you like, soap pellets, just for the hook.
Yeah,
100%. Yeah.
The only thing is, obviously, they'd be a different colour because they're quite unusual. They're like blue there, aren't they?
Yeah, like a bluey green. But yeah, I'm sure you can take any hook bait. I don't think you can use bandoms there. I'm not sure, but any of those normal pellets that you use and you blow them up, that would be fine as hookers, but just don't get caught feeding them.
Yeah, because he'll come down hard on you.
Come down on you like a ton of bricks.
Right, that'll probably do us quite nicely. Oh, this is quite a good one. Rob Williams, who asked you about his inertia reel season up earlier, he stuck it on the radiator, since you suggested, and it's working and running great now.
See? So all that would have been, was if it's quite a new reel as well, they grease all the mechanism inside, and obviously you might have a bit of grease, because it's still cold, isn't it? It's not warm. But yeah, and you've probably just moved a bit of a hard spot in it. See, how good is that?
You just rectified that bloke's problem in the next couple of hours.
What, doing this job, really?
Yeah, well, it's good, isn't it? And it's good to hear that it works as well.
What are you doing with the radiator on? That's what I want, though.
Yeah, it's quite warm, isn't it?
If my miss had the radiator on now, she'd be getting her ass kicked.
Would she?
Oh, yeah. I can't afford having radiators on around here.
Hang on, then. So what are you doing for the rest of the day, then?
I'm going to start doing some gear. I've got some rigs here. I'm going to tie some hooks. I want to do a few bits and pieces. I'm going to check my elastics. But to be honest, obviously a lot of the fishing gear is in my garage, and I've not done a lot of carp fishing over the lockdown, really. Mm. Been doing lots of river fishing now, and I thought I'll check my elastics. I checked me 13 Dura slips the other day. Honestly, I couldn't believe it.
Funny enough, I did that this week.
I got them out, and I thought, I know what'll happen. Like the hollows, they'll be slightly like they're like brand new.
I had some 11s in Des that have been in all last summer. I used them all last summer. I got my top kits out the other day, thinking I need to change them really, and they've all gone pale, like the colour's gone.
Yeah,
but the elastic's perfect.
Like a baby's ass.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it.
And I was trying for, I'll try and break it. Couldn't break it. It's like, brilliant.
But that's, so I ain't got a lot to do, really. It's just getting, I just got to get into the rigs now. Do me rigs that I've been using. And I got, like I said, a match Monday, a match Tuesday, and hopefully then I'll just carry on through to, everything. Just carry on, try and get back to normal. It's going to be a struggle. It's going to be weird. I know it will be. And I'll be under a load of pressure on the Tuesday with what's his name? Richard Chapman. That I ain't looking
for. You'll be all right. Just don't go over in your nets. You'll be fine.
I do get the ump about that. If anybody knows, they know I get the ump about match fishing in filming. It really gets to me, that. It's all right when everything goes to plan. But then it don't go to plan. I get the proper ass then.
Go on, just one last one, because it's quite a nice little talking point. What's the weirdest rule you've ever seen on a commercial fishery?
The weirdest rule. I've probably had some weird ones, I just can't remember.
I always think the no standing up one's a bit of a shocker, isn't it?
Well, yeah, you can't stand up to mug. You can't, you've got to sit down in mug. That's happened on a couple of venues where I go. You're not have to stand up and mug. You're not like, what's it? Oh, there's some other ones, isn't there? There's all sorts of ones. The glee was really weird.
Yeah, no puller bungs for years, wasn't it? You remember?
The glee, yeah, no puller bungs, and you couldn't use an elastic over a certain grade. Well, yeah, I
mean,
every different manufacturer of elastic, you can have like one manufacturer do a 10 to 16. So that didn't make sense to me. That was I went there years and years ago, and they're like, well, you can't use anything over that. And I'm like, right. But that one's real thick there, and it's a 10. Yeah, but you can't use anything over that. Well, hang on, that's stronger than that. But that was that was a weird one. But I think that's all gone now, isn't it?
Yeah.
But weird rules, really.
I'm trying to think of some off the top of my head.
I'll probably add some. I just can't think of them. Oh, I've come over like that sometimes. I'm like, you know what I mean? In the van, I'm like, what? Oh, dead maggots. I'll tell you, there's a venue, I'm not going to mention it, but you can't use dead maggots.
Right.
Well,
what's all that about then?
I don't know. So if you leave them out in the sun, they die. That's all right when you're in the summer, but you can't use dead maggots. People will know what I'm talking about. I've never been there, actually, but that's probably why I haven't never been there. So I'm like, well, I don't get that.
Yeah, it's not for me, that.
But yeah, things like that, it's just a bit silly. But there you go. That's, fishery owners have got their own ways of thinking, aren't they?
And, oh god, yeah.
That's it. But can't think of it at the moment.
So you fishing this weekend?
Well, Saturday and Sunday, obviously. Yeah, I want to go, but I'll probably just—I don't know, really, Joe. I'm not too sure. I'll tell you where I might go. I'll probably go down Bristol Docks. That's been fishing well in certain areas. As long as I can find somewhere to park, there's some big roach coming out down there, which I do fancy. So I think I'm gonna have a day down there, because I love that. And then probably go down there one of the days over the weekend, and then get ready for the match on Monday at Topper. I got a bit of work to do for Topper, because there's going to be that. I think that'd be pretty. I think you're going to want a big weight to win that. You'll probably want £200. I would have thought you'd want £200. So I need to set up. I'm going to start changing. I was just making sure I got some £8 sinking feeder mono, actually, because I'm going to do. I mean, that line I got on my feeder rods, I've had it on there for so long, it's a joke, and I could probably use it again, but I'm going to change it now, And then that'll last me for a lot of the sort of between now and summer.
Yeah.
Be method feeder fishing. So that's what I'm going to do. Strip the reels down, give them a bit of a wash. Because some of my gear is proper manky at the moment. There's one thing I've got to do. I'm going to try and make a little bit of a rod rack in my garage as well. if anybody's got any ideas what they do in their garage. I've got an up and over door, see? I want my rods up there. So if anybody's got any ideas, or if they want to come around and fit it and buy me bike at the same time, come on round. So yeah, so that's it really.
Mm. Nice one then.
All right.
Yeah, all right. Good work.
I cleared up a few things for everybody, and like I said, thanks for the support. I said, like Joe said earlier, we'll try and...
What day are you free next week? Because obviously we've got a bank holiday, haven't we?
Well, I can't do Monday, Tuesday or Wednesday.
Thursday is probably my only day, to be fair.
I reckon Thursday or Friday.
Well, Friday, we're not at work, Des.
Well, Thursday I might be match fishing, so we might have to have a week off. But we'll try and do it Thursday if we can.
Yeah, so, if we can.
We'll try and do it Thursday.
Yeah, all right.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Take care of yourselves. Like I said, thanks for the support. Anybody wants to buy my bike, just get on the phone. It's fine. Message me, Facebook, whatever you want. It's here, ready to go.
Clean, cleansed.
It's clean. It is absolutely spotlessly clean. I'll just give it an oil change, and it's ready to peeve everybody off.
If you sell Preston products like you're selling this bike,
I do.
We could probably retire.
I'm desperate to sell this because my ass is being kicked.
Yeah, I was going to say, your missus is desperate to see it gone, isn't she?
Everybody realises what's going on behind the scenes here at the moment. But anyway, thanks for watching again. Take care, guys, and we'll see you.
Thank you, everyone.
Next week.
See you next week.
Yeah. See you later, boys and girls. Boys.